All right. Okay. So hello, dearsts. Hello and good day. All right. Ayan, good day and welcome to another pre-recorded lecture in our class, no? And our lecture in clinical microscopy. Yes. And for this lecture, ayan. So we're going to start now with the last part of urine analysis, which is of course the microscopic examination of urine, the third and the last part of urine analysis. So again, medyo natagalan na naman, pasensya dears, no, I apologize talaga if medyo dugay dyan ako na record and upload. It's because medyo marami din akong mga ginawa. So pasensya gyud, no? So please watch this lang when you can and on your free time na lang. Okay? So pasensya gyud if medyo delayed na gyud. But anyway, I still hope na you still get to learn something from this lecture, all right? And ma lecture gyapon siya nako properly. All right? So again, pasensya medyo na delayed. All right, so again, we're now at the last part of urine analysis, all right? That's microscopic, no? So we are done with the first two, physical, chemical, and then finally the third part. Now, so I have emphasized from the start pag of the lecture that all three parts of urine analysis are interconnected and interrelated. So you have to correlate with one part with another. All right. So they do not exist individually, all right, or independent of one another. All right. So they are really connected. So as I've mentioned, diba, you correlate on sa may mga results. If kani ang physical, unsa akong ma-expect sa chemical. If kani ang microscopic, unsa dapat ang results sa chemical. So inana siya, no? So you correlate, no? So that you are able to, you are sure, no? You are confident that the results talaga are representative and indicative talaga of what the patient is experiencing and what the disease the patient may have. All right? Okay, so that's for the microscopic. So of course, for the microscopic exam, remember that your urine, no, aside from having dissolved chemical substances or chemical analytes, which we discussed in chemical exam, of course, your urine also contains a lot of substance, a lot of cells and other formed elements. Ayan. So other formed elements, no? So it's not only your dissolved chemical analytes such as your protein, glucose, and all that. But aside from that, of course, your urine may also contain a lot of cells and other formed elements such as crystals and casts, no? And these formed elements also contribute, also point to the possible disease or possible condition that the patient is having, all right? And that is what we are going to discuss in your microscopic examination of your urine, okay? All right, so we're going to start now. Still the same, no, with your chemical exam, I'm still using, still using the handout and PowerPoint presentation of, yes, my Lord, Sister Jemu, no? Very gracious enough to lend his material. So I'm very much grateful. So still the same with chemical exam. There is some information here that is not present in the handout that I sent to you. So again, ang handout kay medyo summarized na gito siya, very, very concise and all. But again, I'll still post this and I'll send this to you, the PDF format of this PowerPoint presentation after this lecture so that you can also study sa mga others na wala pa na ano. Wala sa inyo hang handout. And recently, no, na ko'y friend nag-i-ask, katunitik sa March 2021 na board exam, about sa mga questions sa CM, alright? Kay medyo challenging nag-i daw ang CM recently sa mga board exam. So I asked if unsa ba yun ang mga nagawas, no? So nalimot na siya. Pero iya kong giingnan na majority of the questions came from Brunzel. Ayan, so when I heard that, I was medyo nakampante ko because that's one of the books yun ako ginagamit for this lecture and for your handouts. Okay, so grateful, I'm thankful na at least nigamit na ko Brunzel. Okay, and I'm sure, ayan, yung book, feel na ko daghan ko mga Brunzel na questions gikan, buhon, in your board exam. So, pero again, based sa akong handouts din, katong handouts, it's still majority niya is passenger. Okay? So, don't be ano lang. Kalma lang. If makayang muna, sir, passenger palagi ni. Yes, passenger pa rin itong main reference. But again, for now, maghina-hina na ito sa Brunzel. Okay? But again, when you go to your review season sa different review centers niyo, I'm sure, no, samot na sa Lemar and Pioneer, mga the best, no, I'm sure they're already, they have already adapted talaga and they have already made notes talaga that are coming from Brunzel and mixed references na. Actually, ako mga notes po na ginagamit karon, or akong gihatag ninyo, that's a mix na gyud of different references, all right? Pero siguro when it comes to your review, majority na gyud siguro information coming from Brunzell, as it should din naman. Pero at least as early as now naka-start na ta. As I've mentioned, Brunzell is a good book for for CM, pero medyo TMI siya, very technical. Pero grabe yahang explanations dito, like if wala kayo nasabtan sa stress, pwede kang mo refer sa Brunzell, pero medyo again TMI siya, so baka mas malibog kag sa mood. But anyway, it's really a good book then. All right, anyway, ayan, so chika lang. So again, PowerPoint presentation by Sir Jemu, the best. Okay, all right, so we'll now start with your lecture. Again, when we go to your microscopic exam, as I've mentioned, this is the third part of your urinalysis, all right? And what we're really examining here is what we call the urinary sediment, okay? And this urinary sediment contains a lot of formed elements, no? You have also the organized and disorganized na mga sediments. So later na lang nato na siya discuss sa second part, no? Organized and the unorganized na mga sediments. But anyway, the main purpose is of course to detect and to identify these insoluble materials present in the urine, all right? Again, as I've mentioned, this may include mga formed elements such as casts, cells, and of course other organisms, microorganisms, and of course crystals, all right? Now because again, your urine, take note that it is actually coming from blood, all right? And ang urine pag yun mismo kay mo pass through the different parts of the kidneys, no? And different parts of the urinary system. And remember that your urinary system, kidneys, they're all made up of cells, all right? So there's really it's not a surprise that cells or other formed elements can be seen in your urine because your urine passes through the urinary tract, okay? And these contribute, no, to the appearance of these formed elements in your kidneys. And what are these formed elements? Again, the cells, your RBCs, WBCs, of course, epithelial cells, casts, yes, microorganisms such as bacteria, yeasts, parasites, mucus, spermatozoa, and of course, the crystals and artifacts. So we say artifacts, again, these are contaminants, okay, and they don't have any clinical significance. All right, so for this first part of lecture, ato lang humanon, hopefully, mahuman na to ang the cells na part, okay, before the casts and crystals. Okay, so again, what does it involve? Your microscopic exam, of course, the identification of the urinary sediment, and aside from that, quantitation, no, and reporting of these sediments, okay, because again, the quantity, all right, the number of these formed elements will also give a glimpse as to the severity, all right, or to the condition talaga of the patient. That's why we need to quantitate, okay, and how to report it. So sa later part na lang na siya, sa second part sa lecture. Okay, all right. Now, of course, as I have mentioned, diba, you have to correlate between the physical and the chemical and the microscopic. So here is an example, of course. We can screen macroscopically, no, physical exam. So if when we see this physical exam results, all right, or appearance of your urine, then these are the possible, no, significant microscopic results that we can see. So example, of course, if color, no, blood is the significance, of course, if there's a change in color, definite change in color, diba? The most common abnormal color is, of course, the red, no, red color or red-brown, which indicates the presence of blood. Clarity, of course, hematuria versus hemoglobinuria, okay, we have to differentiate that, okay. And confirm pathologic or non-pathologic cause of pathologic or non-pathologic cause of turbidity. Of course, for blood na chemical exam, what can we see? Or in the microscopic, you have RBCs, RBC casts. Protein, of course, different casts and cells. Nitrite, leukocyte esterase, of course, more on bacteria, WBCs, especially for diagnosing UTI. And glucose, of course, the presence of yeasts. Diba? Remember, as I've mentioned, in patients with uncontrolled DM or in diabetes mellitus or hyperglycemia, of course, one of the possible sediments or one of the possible organisms that can be found in their urine is, of course, the yeasts. All right, because your yeast cells love to thrive in a glucose-rich environment. Aside from that, the glucose in your urine may have upset or may have changed, no, the pH of your urinary tract, which led them to proliferate. Okay, all right. So, naibang laboratories, as we have mentioned here, nakabutang diri that once maklasify ni siya ng mga criteria, like example, ang color kay inani, no, or ang protein kay positive, ang glucose positive, then dito pa sila perform microscopic analysis, all right? Unless maklasify ni siya, then microscopic examination can be foregone, no, or dili na siya pwede, or dili, pwede nang dili i-perform, okay? So that's in a way to improve their cost effectiveness, okay? But generally, routinely yun, bahala unsay result, no? Their microscopic analysis is part yun of routine urinalysis, alright? So para at least bahala normal ra ang chem, normal ra ang physical exam, of course, to be very sure, alright, we have to examine the microscopic, diba? Because we have mentioned, we have discussed, diba, that although the physical and chemical exam, they can already give, no, presumptive identification or information, there could still be a lot of results there na possible na dili or like negative siya in the physical or chemical exam, pero sa microscopic na siya, di ba? Remember, chemical exams are also, the parameters, especially the reagent strips, are very much affected by interferences, all right? For physical exam, example, of course, it's not necessary that if the specimen is clear, there are not, it doesn't already contain a lot of cells or possible na mga important or significant na mga formed elements. So, routinely pa rin, bahala na, positive ba, negative, yung mga chemical strip or chem parameters, microscopic analysis pa rin is routinely performed together with physical and chemical. Alright, so three steps yun ng urinalysis, routinely. Alright, pero na yung mga laboratories that they, no, they modify their methodologies siguro to save, no, and to be cost effective. Alright, but routinely, it's still performed ang microscopic exam regardless, no, of the results of the physical and chemical exam. Okay, alright. Now, of course, what are some of the specimen preparation for your microscopic exam? This is still from Strassinger. Of course, the best specimen, you need to use fresh or adequately preserved specimens. True enough, the best specimen, good dears, if microscopic, ang imuhang ganahan or imuhang test yun is of course the first morning specimen. Because the first morning specimen is the most concentrated and the most acidic, okay? Because again, after prolonged, no, standing of your urine in normal temperature or unpreserved siya, it becomes alkaline. And alkaline urine will induce the disintegration of your casts and cells. Whereas for acidic urine, it preserves, no, your cells and casts. And that's why the first morning specimen is the best specimen of choice, no? Or the specimen of choice for microscopic analysis. Alright? Ayan, as I've mentioned here, first morning ang best or specimen of choice. Pero routinely, of course, hago naman, no, ang imuhang first morning. So the random specimen or midstream clean catch would suffice. It would be enough. Okay? Alright. But if ang question kay specimen of choice for microscopic exam, of course, it's your first morning specimen. Alright. Next, of course, warm refrigerated specimens at 37 degrees Celsius. Because during refrigeration, refrigeration may induce or may force, no, or may cause precipitation of the amorphous urates and phosphates, all right? And these amorphous urates and phosphates, as we have discussed in the physical exam, they may cause turbidity, all right? Non-pathologic causes of turbidity. Although they are non-pathologic, its main disadvantage is, of course, because it causes turbidity, they may interfere with your examination, all right? So if ever magani ni precipitate imuhang sample, all right, after refrigeration, you may warm the temperature, you may warm the specimen at 37 degrees Celsius for a short time to dissolve these amorphous, non-pathologic na mga phosphates and urates. But routinely, of course, if wala lang, no, you could not perform, if ever wala rani precipitate or wala rani turbidity after refrigeration, then you can forego the warming part, alright? Basta make sure lang, di ba? Remember that once the specimen is refrigerated, you have to let it return, no? You have to let it stand muna for how many minutes to return its temperature to room temperature. Because again, ngano ganito? Because your enzymatic reactions in the chem strip or reagent strip are temperature dependent. Okay? Alright. Of course, number three, if wala'y first morning specimen, of course, the best specimen next is midstream clean catch. Ngano gani? Because the midstream clean catch in a way minimizes no contamination from the urethra. Alright? Because again, middle part of the urine, diba? Remember sa itong intro to UA? So ang first flow sa urine will not be collected. In a way, this first flow will flush off, no, the cells, bacteria found in their urethra. And of course, at least the second part or the middle part you will now be ensured that at least this part of your urine is free from the contaminants. Okay? All right. Or minimizes, yeah, the contaminants. And lastly, of course, as we have mentioned before, you examine, you have to mix, no? You have to mix the specimen. Thoroughly mix the specimens before decanting into your test tubes. Because remember, your formed elements, especially cells, they can settle at the bottom of your container once they are left standing, yes, on your countertops or dito sa inyong mga table. Of course, if it will be left standing for pila ka minutes or pila ka hours, the cells, formed sediments or formed cells, will settle at the bottom. Now, if you don't mix it before transferring to the test tube, it may affect your microscopic, of course, because you cannot see the cells. Kaya wala na-appeal ang mga cells, kaya nabilin sa container. Aside from that, of course, a chemical exam, we have discussed that. Blood and leukocyte esterase, especially, will be affected. Because remember that blood and leukocyte esterase detect RBCs and WBCs, respectively. So if they will not be included into the test tube for your testing, of course, then your reagent strip cannot detect any cells, WBCs or RBCs, for your reagent strip. So it could lead to false negative results. Okay, so make sure to thoroughly mix. Again, swirl lang the specimen, no, in the container cup slowly para po dili siya mayabo. Alright, slowly swirl the specimen, no, in your container. And then after swirling, you then transfer it to your test tube. Okay, now what is the specified amount, no, or standard amount of volume needed for your examination? Of course, the range is about 10 to 15. Alright, pero an average of 12 ml. Would suffice. Okay, so here's an example, of course, your container. All right, so again, make sure to spin or to swirl to mix the specimen, and then of course you transfer that into your test tube. No, the best would be conical test tubes, because the conical test tube will facilitate the sedimentation, no, or the sediments will be really kanang makuag yun siya sa ilalong because of the conical part sa tube. Okay, that's the best. But of course, if wala conical test tubes kay pobre chara, kay wala pa ano, the normal glass test tubes would be okay din naman. All right? Okay, ayan, just like what we use in your routine laboratory. Okay, the glass test tubes would suffice. Okay, all right. Ayan. Okay, sige. All right. Sige, ako lang gi-check kung basin ako yung malimtan. Okay, all right. Sige, all right, continue. We then continue with, of course, the centrifugation. Remember that after you transfer your specimen into your test tube, we then subject it to centrifugation. Of course, this centrifugation will separate now the different form elements into and gather them into one sediment at the bottom of the test tube. Now, what is the duration? At least, no, at least 5 minutes, or 5 minutes yun mismo. Now, the speed in RPM is 1,500 to 2,000 RPM. Pero kung RCF, or relative centrifugal force, it's about 400 to 450. Alright? Usually, in different references, sa Strass and sa Brunzel, ilang dimension ko is 400 RCF or 400 times G. Because this RCF na unit would not depend on the centrifuge type. Okay? Because your RPM, it would depend on the centrifuge type. Okay? So, if ang standard your dears na speed is RCF, no, 400 times G, 400 RCF or 400 times G, 400 to 450. That's the standardized, in a way, na speed. Alright? Ilang dimension RCF yun sa ilang mga books. Because if RPM ang good, RPM is dependent on the type of centrifuge. Alright? Sa formula, no, to convert RCF to RPM, kailangan natin murag formula, na-appel sa formula ang radius sa imuhang centrifuge, something, or radius of the rotor. So it would depend talaga on the centrifuge ang RPM. So, that's why kung pangutanon mo, alright, or ang gibutang gid sa Strass or sa Brunzel is RCF. That's why basin makathink mo ng anong RCF. It's because of that. No, RCF is in a way more standardized because it does not depend on the centrifuge that you use, no, for the calculation of the RCF. Whereas for RPM, it depends on the centrifuge. But anyway, if pangutanon mo sa RPM, then that's about 1,500 to 2,000. That's why range na siya, 1,500 to 2,000. Because naiubang centrifuge na ang 400 RCF kay 1,500 RPM. Naiubang centrifuge na ang 400 RCF kay mga 2,000 RPM. So, in a way, range siya. No? So, muna siya speed niya. Alright? Now, again, very important reminder, do not use the braking mechanism. Ayan. So, of course, wrong spelling madagay ni. Breaking. Ito ba yung tama? Break as in breaking. Wait lang. Let me check. I think parang mali. Breaking. Yeah, break as in break na BR. Ako na lang i-change. Breaking. Do not use the breaking mechanism pang break. Okay? Alright. Because again, in a way, this would resuspend, no? Example, naka-form na ito siya sediment sa ilalim, pero pag break ni mo, di ba, na abruptly stop siya, so what happens is matandog tong sediment, no? It will be agitated, ma-resuspend balik ang mga cells, no? Sa imuhang fluid. So what happens is, pag-examine ni mo, possible na nakuhaan na itong mga cells sa sediment. So, possible it could lead to false negative results na. Alright, now calibration of course, we have discussed this in the first part of the lecture. Pinakaunag yun na to. Tachometer, of course, to measure the speed. Alright, or strobe light, di ba? Take note of that, dears. Tachometer, strobe light, and stopwatch for timing. Take note of that. So again, for speed, tachometer, strobe light, nako. As in, very press the buzzer. And of course, stopwatch for timing. All right, that's for centrifugation of your samples. Okay, all right, sige. Okay, all right, so I'm checking. Baka may nakalimutan ako. Okay, all right, sige. Now we go now to your, of course, to your procedure, no? So of course, after centrifugation, di ba? As based on experience, ma-separate ang fluid and the sediment. So what you do next is, of course, you decant, all right? Or pipette, okay? So of course, the best procedure is to pipette because para at least pag decant magudi mo, pwedeng ma-appeal tong other sediments, okay? At least for pipetting, no? Diretso yun makuha ang sediment sa ilalim because you're using a pipette. But for routine purposes here sa itong mga classifieds, decanting, bottoms up, di ba? So, okay rin naman, okay? So you decant, alright, to remove the fluid. And then of course, the remaining sediment there, alright, will be resuspended, okay, by the fluid na nabilin sa kilid sa test tube, di ba? So ito siyang i-agitate konti, no? Di po kay harsh, okay? Kay pwede ma-destroy ang mga cells if harsh ni mo pag-agitate. But at least slowly lang to resuspend the sediment na nabilin, alright? And this volume is about 0.5 ml or 1 ml. 0.5 ml to 1 ml of that. Muna siya itong examine. Okay? So, we then get a volume there. Alright? And the volume is approximately about 20 microliters or 0.02 milliliters. Okay? So, that's the sample lagyan na kailangan, no? From the 0.5 to 1 ml na nabilin sa test tube after decantation, okay, we get about mga 20 microliters or 0.02 ml for examination. We place that in your slide, glass slide, and of course, cover slip, and then examine under the microscope. All right, so here's some picture. Diba, you have the left there is the after centrifugation, na separate ng liquid, and then the sediment at the ilalim. And of course, after decantation, na mabilin na fluid, na urine, actually, daghan gani kayo na mabilin dira. Kanina sa number right, so right. Pero at least, muna siya mabilin, then you resuspend, meaning mo siyang i-agitate or shake konti, no? Dili kayo harsh. Ayan. And then of course, get a drop or 20 ul and then place it on a slide and then examine under the microscope. Alright. Okay, but generally, routinely, good dears, no, according to Brenzel, good, the use of glass slides is not already recommended because ang glass slides man good and cover slips, they are not standardized. Okay? So, possible na pwede siyang ma-affected. Okay? And pwede po na yung mga ma-miss. Alright? Na mga sediments. Okay? If ever mo gamit yun ka o glass slides, according to Brenzel niya, if mo gamit yun ka glass slides, dapat exact amount yun ato ipipet. Meaning mo gamit yun tag-automatic na pipet. So about 20 ul or 15 ul yun so atong kwaon. To really ensure na chakto atong makuha. Alright? Because ang iyahang recommended na, the recommended now is using commercial standardized slides, and they're usually made up of plastic, okay? And inside the commercial standardized slides, no, they have already the glass, the cover slip, and a glass cover slip na na-added to, alright? So, basically, kung commercial glass commercialized systems na siya, usually, pwede siyang machine na yun mismo ang mo-transfer, no? So, in a way, at least, since machine naman yun ang mo-transfer, it's really standardized na, okay? Alright. And aside from that, naay chamber imuhang commercial glass slides, and this technique in a way kay naay chamber ma uniformly distributed jud imuhang sediments kay chamber, like chamber, no? Like chamber or murag hole or murag depression dito, alright? So in a way, pag butang nimo sa imong sediment or sa imong sample, ma-evenly distribute imong sediments. That's why it's really recommended ng commercialized systems, alright? But because of course, in low, you know, low laboratory, low income laboratories or mga developing countries, of course, na medyo dili pa kaayo na naka-accessible ang commercialized systems, this routine performance, no, of using glass slides is still naman, it's still accepted din naman. As long as, you know, it's standardized yung procedure, no? Like, i-stipulate yung sa inyong laboratory na dapat pila ka drops rang kuwaon, how many minutes yun ang centrifugation, no? Unsay speed, dapat standardized yun siya. In a way, para at least ma-minimize, no, ang mga differences in terms of the different processing, no, of different laboratories, okay? So muna siya ato ang iiwasan. At least standardized na to, no? Pila ka minutes yun, pila ang speed, no? How much of the remaining fluid yun ang kuwaon, mugamit makag pressure pipette or automatic pipette, and na. Okay, so dapat na siyang ma-standardized sa inyong laboratory. Okay? All right, sige. So that's for the transferring of your sample to the slides. Okay. Now again, this is the procedure, diba? 10 to 15 ml of your urine, average of about 12 ml, centrifuge again at 400 or 450 RCF for 5 minutes, decant or pipette, okay? Again, it's in a volume about 0.5 to 1 ml, transfer about 20 ul or 0.02 ml into a glass slide with 22 by 22 millimeters cover slip, and of course, examine microscopically. You first examine in your LPF, no, low power objective or low power fields, and then of course, followed by HPF, high power field, and take note, reduced light. So, dapat dili nyo siya pahayagan kayo, dears, no? Because again, remember that there are some sediments such as your casts, hyaline casts, mucus that are low ilahang refractive index, meaning pwede silang pag hayag ra kaayo pwede silang mawala sa field because low ilahang refractive index. Okay, so dapat reduced light. Okay, ayan, sige, that's for the urine sediment preparation, a summary of procedure. So again, what are the rules in your examination? Of course, the first rule, dapat when using a bright field microscope when examining your sediment, dapat again subdued light or reduced light to provide adequate contrast. Because again, if too much ang light, possible na mawala to mga sediments na taas kay, na low og refractive index such as your casts and mucus. So pag pasabot ana, ilahang refractive index kay quite similar to your urine. So pag hayag kaayo, pwedeng mubled na sila sa background, okay? Because again, medyo same as like refractive index sa urine. All right? So how do you reduce your light source or ano? Subdued light, of course, imuhang diaphragm, imo siya dapat ipailalom good, no? And then, imong diaphragm is partially closing the diaphragm, and the condenser is imo siyang ipailalom good. Like, imo siyang i-adjust downward until your optimum contrast is achieved. So, imo siyang i-adjust downward, okay, imuhang condenser. So, medyo i-close ang diaphragm, and then adjust your condenser downward. Okay, until paglantaw ni mo medyo okay na makita na itong mga low og refractive index. Okay, alright, ayan, sige. That's for the first rule. The second rule is, of course, your fine adjustment knob should be continuously adjusted. So, after ni mo mag-LPO, di ba? After LPO, of course, magamit sa coarse adjustment. Okay, until mo clear na yung field. Alright, so the next is you use na the fine adjustment pagabot sa HPO and pwede po sa LPO to sharpen the image. Okay, ang initial focusing will be performed by the coarse adjustment, pero ang sharpening of the image will be performed by the fine adjustment na. Okay, so take note of that. So basic na lang na microscopy. Okay, so take note of that. Now remember that mag-start kag LPO. Now scan the entire field of your LPO because again, or scan the entire field good of your cover slip because again, especially apil ang mga sides because casts, no, mga heavy na mga sediments such as casts can be pushed towards the side of your cover slip. Okay? So, if dilin mo siya examine sa kilid, pwede nimo ma-miss ang mga casts. Alright? So, examine first sa LPO and then, of course, quantitate ka itong mga sediments na dapat examine under LPO and then, of course, after which, you can proceed to HPO. Pero, again, pwede mapud ka na in the middle of examining the LPO, you can shift to HPO, especially if you're examining a cast and you want to determine kung what type of cast is it. Is it a, especially if cellular cast siya, is it RBC ba? WBC cast? And, of course, these cells can be seen clearly or seen more clearly in your HPO. So if you want to determine what type of cast it is, imong gi-examine, especially if cellular cast siya, then you can shift to HPO, all right, while examining the LPO. So, example, LPO, kita kag-cast, all right, and then ganahan ka na, i-identify unsa siya na-cast, pwede kang mo shift to HPO, okay, nana. And then after identifying, balik na po kag-LPO, if wala pa ka nahuman, o examine sa entire field under LPO. So, after na ka mo examine sa entire field under LPO, shift na ka to HPO, and then, you then examine for the needed sediments na makita sa HPO. Mga RBCs, WBCs, no? So, ganun. Alright, okay, sige. That's for your examination. Alright, now again, of course, how do we examine the sediment? Of course, we use a microscope. Diba, muna akong atong subject kay clinical microscopy. Alright, AUBF. Your microscope talaga is the best friend of a medtech, one of the best friends, especially when examining urine and blood and all that. Because again, we can see the necessary or the needed na mga cells and all that. So again, routinely, no, in the laboratory, we use the bright field, no, the bright field microscope. And for your urine, ang recommended number of fields, bahalag HPO or LPO, is at least 10. So greater than equal to 10 fields. Alright, take note, unsa ra na objectives ang ginagamit, LPO and HPO. For oil immersion, pwedeng dinatakabot og oil immersion kay possible na medyo ang resolution niya, especially sa mga other sediments, medyo dili na klaro. Alright, so pwede natagkutob rag LPO and HPO. Alright, so again, number of microscopic slides, LPO or HPO magani, pila ka fields, greater than or equal to 10 fields. Okay. All right. Ayan, sige. So that's for routine. All right. But of course, we also have other microscopes that we can use, especially in examining urine and other body fluids. All right. So of course, you have the bright field microscopy. As mentioned here, it's for routine urinalysis. All right. Now, second is, of course, the phase contrast microscopy. All right. So what it does, this is usually used for sediments with low refractive indices, such as your casts and mga mucus, all right? So what very important characteristic, dears, it produces a halo of light. Ayan, take note of that, dears, ha? Lumabas sa boards. Produces a halo of light around the object, all right? Ayan, naka-mention dira, produces a halo, that's phase contrast microscopy. And according to Brenzel, this is the preferred technique talaga for microscopic examination of your urine sediment. Remember sa bright field, mga good dears, kay medyo ang ubang sediments, dili kayo maklaro, actually, no? Lisod lang tao ng uban, lisod ma-identify ang ubang sediments, especially katong mga low refractive indices such as your casts and all that, diba? I'm sure you naka-experience mo, medyo difficult kid siya. But for phase contrast, katong ng mga casts, especially mga low refractive indices, mas maklaro siya, alright? So we'll discuss a brief lang, no? Unsay principle sa phase contrast, and the different types of microscopes, kay medyo, ano siya, dears, TMI, and medyo weak din ako ang knowledge, ani, kay mga physics-related, so pasensya. Pero we'll do our best to at least give you a glimpse, no? Of unsay ang principle. Pero ang purpose lagi sa phase contrast, katong mga low refractive indices, meaning katong pwedeng ma-miss, pwedeng mo-blend sa background, if taas kay mong light, alright, of ayag ra kaayo, alright, kay mas maklaro siya. Because again, in a way, na ay differences in their face, no, in the light that they reflect or refract padulong sa objective or padulong sa imong eyepiece, that's why maklaro sila, no? So, naa sila'y dark areas, napoy light areas, ganun, which, in a way, provides contrast na best good na makita. Okay? So, mas makita sila. And again, take note, unsay hang i-produce na halo, alright? Halo of light around the object. Okay, next you have polarizing microscopy. Ayan, kaning polarizing. So this is usually used for identification of your cholesterol, oval fat bodies, of course, fatty casts, and crystals. Very important, especially when we go to synovial fluid, if naka-abot na mo drag tuon, di ba? Na mga birefringence, polarizing, yes. Because that's best used, ang polarizing microscopy, it's best used for your crystals. Okay, next, of course, dark field. Naku, alam nyo na yarn. This is for your spirochetes, of course. Especially treponema pallidum, subspecies pallidum is in cases of syphilis. Nakatunang disseminated, okay, na maputan siya sa urine, okay? And of course, fluorescence microscopy, alam nyo na rin yan, we use fluorochromes or fluorophores, alright? Excite na to, no, using light, alright? And they will emit light of a longer wavelength and lower energy. Naku, Sana naman remember pa what is the characteristic of light emitted, no, in your fluorescent microscopy by the specimen or light emitted is longer wavelength and lower energy. Okay, all right. So yes, and last is the interference contrast microscopy. You have two types. You have the Nomarski, which is the differential contrast, and Hoffman, which is modulation. Now take note. Yeah, very important in characteristic dears. It produces a 3D image. Ayan, 3D image and layer by layer imaging of the specimen. So 3D image gyud mo makita and mas klaro siya, no, and mas really high definition, HD gyud siya, no? Like 3D gyud siya and very high end. Aside from that, bright field microscope can be adapted. Actually, sa kaning tanang microscopes, dears, you can use the bright field microscope. You just have to edit, no, or edit. You have to modify lang some parts of the bright field microscope. Nakay kuwaon, then nakay i-add, nakay i-change, no, nakay gamito na filters, etc., etc. All right, so all of this actually can be, no, coming or can be adapted from a bright field microscope. All right, so we'll start first with the phase contrast na principle ng dears. Again, take note dears, I'm not good at this. Inaamin ko na. All right, so I'll be honest na lang talaga na I'm not good at this mga kaning mga physics related, pero I'll do my best to explain, no. So for phase contrast, as you can see, you use two in a way filters. You have number one, the condenser annulus or the annulus diaphragm, annulus ring, ayan, and the face ring, ayan, or face plate. So what you do is bright field microscope, you can say bright field microscope, pwede mo siya exchange to phase contrast. How do you do that? You need two ka-filters. You have the condenser annulus and you have the face ring. So kani condenser annulus, ibutanin mo siya sa diaphragm, ayan, the pit sa diaphragm, alright, or there is a light source there, sorry. And then imo ang face plate kay there is objective, alright. So what it does is, ang light source, no, the condenser annulus, what happens, kay iyahang i-direct ang light beam into one region lang or one area or one light beam padulong yun sa imuhang specimen lang. Alright? And this specimen light, pag abot diri sa sa faceplate, alright, ang iyahang madawat na light is already diffracted, alright, in a different phase na kiniagi siya sa specimen. So ang specimen ang ni-diffract sa light, okay? And depende sa unsa na type of asa na region sa imuhang face ring musulod ang light na na-diffract sa imong specimen. So example, if imuhang light kay naabot diri sa kilid, all right, or diri sa darker area, that will ang imo makita or it will show the dark region of your specimen. And then kung diri dapit sa gawas, no, or sa tunga, wala siya naabot sa kanang black na ring, it will produce the light part, no, kato medyo hayag, bright area of your specimen. So phase contrast, when you say phase contrast, it's more focusing on the light, no, the different phases of light, okay. So what happens is, of course, imuhang light waves, they are modified or diffracted pag agi nila sa specimen, all right. And these differences in phases muna siya imuhang gigamit, no, giutilize to produce the image. Ayan, in a nutshell, dears, as in medyo complex siya, pero pasensya, sana naman nagets lang yun, all right. So na-identify two filters na gumiton when you need to convert muna siya imong need. What you need to remember, dears, kana mga how to convert the bright field microscope to the different microscope. Okay, usually gina-ask na siya sa boards and sa mga exams, no? So for phase contrast, again, how do you convert? You need two, no? You need two filters. Again, you have the annular diaphragm ring, okay, na nasa condenser itself or pwedeng below sa condenser. And the last one is the phase ring, all right, which is imo ibutang siya sa imuhang objective. Okay, all right. Next, sa phase contrast, again, because of that, it produces, again, a halo of light. Nako, press the buzzer, take note of that, around the object being studied. Next, you have the polarizing microscope. Ayan. So for polarizing microscope, it follows the principle of polarizing. No? Unpolarized light, meaning normal na light lang, your light travels in different directions. Okay, but what the polarizer does is, iyahang i- focus, no, ang imuhang light into one direction lang. Okay, so that's the purpose of polarizing. So pag focus niya sa light, okay, that one light beam will be focused by the polarizer, okay. And pag agi niya, if moagi siya sa usa ka substance na birefringent, ayan, dira na nagawa sa atong term na birefringent, the birefringent material will diffract the light into two perpendicular directions. So example, ayan, kanisya, kanisya imuhang birefringent material. As you can see, from east to west na direction, ayan, iyahang gi separate ang light into east and west and north and south. So that's perpendicular, meaning 90 degrees ang direction to the both waves, no? The 90 degrees ilang direction the in the both of for the both of the waves, all right? So perpendicular ilang pag separate, okay? So that's the purpose. Muna siya point sa birefringent. When we say birefringent, sa lahat ng mga substances na mu diffract or mu separate sa light into two, no? Two directions lang perpendicular to each other, all right? So of course, kasi to mga birefringent, mga crystals, no? Mga casts na uban, okay? Inana. So that's the point of polarizing, okay? The polarizing microscope. Okay, all right. Now, how do you convert the polarizing microscope, the bright field microscope to a polarizing microscope? You need two filters, Yapon. Ayan, you have the polarizer, which is a condenser. Ayan, saan ito dapat? Ito, polarizer, kanisya na filter, polarizing filter, and another polarizing filter that is a eyepiece dapat, which is known as the analyzer. So, same Yapon, two filters. You need a polarizer sa condenser, and you have the analyzer dapat sa eyepiece. Okay, so for phase contrast, duhapod ka filters. For polarizing, duhapod ka filters. Take note of that, dears. Okay, ako lang ni siyang i-summarize, ato sa akong notes na iapas na summary. Okay, how to convert, as in, lumalabas talaga. Alright, okay. Now, for the interference contrast, dears, again, very important lang. Remember, for modulation, for dark field microscope, of course, on how to convert the bright field microscope to dark field, you add a dark field filter or stopper diri dapit sa condenser. Para again, ang imuhang background kay dark, and then the object under examination is sila ang hayag. Muna siya dark field, di ba? Okay. And for fluorescence, of course, as you can see, you have the light excitation filter, dichroic mirror, padulong sa imuhang specimen, which contains the fluorophore, and it absorbs sa fluorophore ang light, ma-excite sila, and then mo-release siya og light, no, mo-emit siya light pabalik dito sa padulong na sa eyepiece, all right? And this is what we see. That is your fluorescence, okay? All right. And then lastly, of course, the interference contrast. Ayan. So for interference contrast, you have number one, the modulation contrast. So as you can see, ang gi-modify mo kay ang light path, okay? Ang light path na put sa imuhang light, and that is translated to differences in intensity. As you can see, you use a modulator, okay? And depending on the light, okay, depending on the region sa modulator na iba na dark, gray, or bright na light, muna yung makita or muna yung i-emit padulong sa imuhang eyepiece, which you see. Alright? Now, for differential interference, as you can see, muyo siya mga prisms. Alright? So, it follows in a way the principle of polarizing. Alright? Polarizing. Kaya magamit siya filters and mga prisms. Alright? Still, padulong sa imuhang eyepiece, imuhang light. Okay? So, again, in a nutshell, dear sa, pasensya na good if dili kayo na naka-in-depth. Kaya medyo weak po na ito ang knowledge, ani. Pero I hope na-gets lang to siya. Alright? Okay. So, here's a summary. This is from your Brunzel Gapon in terms of the characteristics of the microscopy. No? Again, kung preferred yun ang storyaan, the preferred microscopic technique yun is phase contrast. Pero routine is your bright field. Okay? Because ang bright field man good, again, daghan yung possible na ma-miss. Kaya na yung mga sediments na di kayo maklaro or mo-blend sa background. Whereas for phase contrast, pwede man good silang maklaro. No? Because again, mo-produce lag halo of light, and then napay mga, makita to mga darker areas, darker regions of the sediment, so mas maklaro good siya. Interference contrast, in a way, mas tiyada good siya kay 3D. Alright? 3D good ang image. Mas mo-pop out good siya yung image. Klaro good siya, no? Pero again, it could be costly. That's why wala kayo siya ginagamit routinely. Pero yung advantage is, in a way, same siya og picture sa phase contrast. Pero ang difference sa interference contrast is that, again, wala na siya halo. No, wala yung halo of light na makita niya. 3D image siya. That's for interference contrast. Okay? Alright, so I hope na-gets lang to siya, dears. And here are some pictures. Ayan, as you can see, this is phase contrast na cast, di ba? So you can see, klaro dyan kayo siya. And then, ay halo of light, no? Mara siya bukod na pinagpala. Yes, mga blessed. Siya dyan ang blessed, no? Nakalang na light yun sa likod ba? O, di ba? Halo of light, phase contrast. Polarizing, as you can see, crystals. Ayan, mo exhibit siya different colors, no? Because that's in terms of asa nila padulong ang light na iyahang gi-diffract or gi-polarize. And then you have interference contrast, as you can see, 3D image na gid siya. Alright? Pero as you can see, wala na siya halo of light sa likod. Okay? Unlike your phase contrast. So wala na akong dibutaw yung picture sa fluorescence and dark field kasi alam nyo na. Okay? Alright, kanina siya. Okay? So take note of that, dears, the different types of microscope we use for urine analysis. Okay? And even other body fluids na examination. Alright! Okay, now we have this historical no method of determining and quantitating your formed elements, and this is known as your Addis count. All right. Now, the Addis count, which was discovered by Thomas Addis, right, it's mainly used talaga for detection and monitoring of disease progression, especially sa kidneys. All right. Because in disease progression or in kidney disease na pag-progress, if mas magkadugay siya, mas of course daghang cells na makita. All right. And that's the principle of your Addis count. So it is a quantitative formula. All right. So far, wala namang computation sa boards for Addis, so that's good. Okay, all right. Just remember lang again, it's yung mga normal values and the specimen of choice. So of course, 12-hour urine. Basta gani quantitative testing, no? The best is your time specimen, because again, that would in a way get no or concentrate tanan cells possible na mga sediments na naa sa imuhang urine. Okay, and what is the preservative, pwedeng formally. Alright, normal values, 0 to 500,000 for RBCs. For WBC, 0 to 1,800,000. And for hyaline cast, 0 to 5,000. Now, if the values after computation for your Addis count came greater than 500,000, 1,800,000, and 5,000, then that's considered to be abnormal. Okay? But if within that range pa, of course, normal pala. Alright, that's Addis count. Okay. Now, another way para ma-improve atong examination of your sediments is, of course, through the use of said stains. Alright? Now, take note for stains, the most commonly used urinary stain is, of course, your Sternheimer-Malbin. And what is Sternheimer-Malbin? It's a supravital stain. Ayan, meaning, pagkuha pa lang daan mo sa urine, okay, buhi pa or medyo alive pa mga cells, i-stain na mo siya daan. I-stain na mo siya daan, supravital. So you don't fix it, wala pa kayo na destroy or na matay ang cells, alright, yun mo na siyang gi-stain, okay? So supravital, alright? So crystal violet plus saffronin, same principle with reticulocyte na staining using dumethylene blue or brilliant crystal blue, supravital staining. All right. So, unsay compositions sa Sternheimer-Malbin, crystal violet and gram stain and saffronin. Take note. So, take note, dears, no? So, muna siya yahang stains, no? Ang Sternheimer-Malbin stain is one stain and yahang composition is both crystal violet and saffronin together. Okay, gimix sila. So, how do I remember siya ang gram stain na mga stains, diba? Crystal violet and saffronin, siya ang mga gram stain na mga stains. So, Sternheimer-Malbin, the most common, the most commonly used urinary sediment stain is your Sternheimer-Malbin. Yahang action is, of course, delineates structure and contrasting colors of your nucleus and cytoplasm. The function is, of course, for WBCs, epithelial cells, and casts. So actually, it can stain a lot, no? That's why it is used as the most common urinary sediment stain. Next is, of course, toluidine blue, 0.5% toluidine blue. It's usually used for WBCs, no? Supravital stain po siya. It can differentiate the WBCs from your RTEs because the nucleus, atong natawan ang nuclei sa WBCs, mas stain siya. So that's why it's considered to be it's used, no, for differentiation of WBCs and RTEs. Next, you have 2% acetic acid. No, 2% acetic acid is not actually a stain, but in a way, it can be used to differentiate different sediments, especially RBCs and other sediments. Because in the addition of 2% acetic acid, your RBCs will be lysed, and the other sediments or other cells will not be lysed. Aside from that, your 2% acetic acid will also accentuate, or it will magnify, no, or it will sharpen the image or the nuclei of your WBC. So mas maklaro siya. Enhances the nuclei of your WBC. So again, as I mentioned, distinguishes RBCs from WBCs, yeast, oil droplets, and crystals. Next is, of course, the lipid stains. So oil red O, Sudan 3, and Sudan 4, pwede put. So the lipid stains. This is used to detect, again, lipids, especially neutral fats. And what are neutral fats? The triglycerides. Okay, ayan. Triglycerides and neutral fats. And so yung color, orange, red. So para kinsani, of course, for those sediments na possible na naay, fats na involved, no, such as the oval fat bodies and mga fatty casts. Alright. But take note, it cannot stain cholesterol. Alright. So take note of that. The lipid stains cannot stain your cholesterol. So how do you determine cholesterol? You need to perform polarizing or you need to examine the specimen under a polarizing microscope. Okay? Because again, the cholesterol will exhibit a Maltese cross appearance. Tako, my gosh, press the buzzer. Okay. Ayan, sige. Next, of course, gram stain, wag na mo isip, it's for bacteria. Alright? Gram positive, gram negative, wala nang iba. usually used for bacterial cast to determine kung unsa yahang composition. Next, we have the Hansel stain ako. Unsay composition niya, eosin Y, and of course, methylene blue. And kanisha, this is really specific for your eosinophils. Ayan, identification of urinary eosinophils. Mujo na siya yung primary use of your Hansel stain. Very, very specific for the eosinophils. Next, for Prussian blue, we have mentioned this chemical exam, diba? It's used for hemosiderin. The Ruse test, okay? Prussian blue, of course, it will detect or it will stain your hemosiderin granules color blue. Okay, all right. Next, you have kaning last two dears. These are the stains used in automated microscopy. Take note, dears. Lumalabas talaga sa boards. Put. No, so asa ni siya gikan from Strassinger na 5th edition. Kanang mga appendix, no? Ditong dapita. Wala na magod ni siya sa 6th edition, I think. Kaning duha ka stain. So take note, phenanthridine. Ayan, phenanthridine. Ano siyang ginastain? Letter D, DNA. All right. Ano siyang color? Orange. Okay. For carbocyanin, siya ang color green. And kasi gina-detate, since yung mga gina-stain, you have the negative, no, na mga substances or negative na mga parts sa imuhang cells, such as your nuclear membranes, mitochondria, and cell membranes. Take note of that. The two major stains used for automated microscopy, phenanthridine and carbocyanin. So, phenanthridine is orange, carbocyanin is green. So, how do I remember? So, pagawas na to ang whiteboard. All right, so phenanthridine, di ba? Spelling niya, phenanthridine. Ayan, so nasa ay letter D. So kinsa ang ginastain? Ang letter D po, DNA. All right, make note of that. So how do you remember? Phenanthridine, na letter D. Kinsa ang ginastain? Ang letter D, DNA. Ano siyang orange? Ah, ano siyang color? Orange. Ayan. So, how do you remember lang sa color? OPGC. Okay, ano lang. But for how, ano siyang ginastain? DNA. Basta ng question kayo, which of the following stains DNA? Nako. Stains DNA color orange in your automated microscopy. Nako, press the buzzer. Phenanthridine. Kung siya na letter D, siya ang mustain sa letter D, DNA. No, I missed the D. Charot, check lang. And for carbocyanin, which is color green, mustain siya sa nuclear and cell membranes and the mitochondria. Ayan, take note of that. Okay, ayan. And take note, there's wala na ako nabutang din sa inyong notes, no? Natin question sa boards, no? The cova stain is composed of blank. Ayan. The cova stain is a type of blank. Ayan. So, it's a type of black na stain, ganun. That's the question. Now remember that the cova stain is just, you know, it is just Sternheimer Malbin. Pinaganda niya lang. The Sternheimer Malbin stain, commercially good, is sold under two or under different na mga brand names. One of that is of course cova stain and the other is sedi stain. Take note of that, dear sa. So the question gito, cova stain is composed of, or magang other, or the question was cova stain is a type of ganun. So marasag gi ask siya kung sa type of stain ang cova stain. Now take note, the cova stain is a Sternheimer Malbin stain. So it is made up of crystal violet and saffrony. Take note of that. Okay, all right, so that's four the different sediment stains. Okay? Alright, take note. Ayan. So here are some color, here are some results or some pictures. You have Sternheimer Malbin, epithelial cells, 0.5% tall within blue. As you can see, klaro kayang nuclei, simuhang WBCs. Lipid stains, ayan. Oval fat bodies, ayan. Kani mga orange-red na mga globules there, that's the fats, mga droplets. And then you have, of course, Hansel stain, color orange na granules. Okay? That's for your eosinophils. Okay. All right. And this is from Strassinger lang, dears, the summary, no? This is from using Sternheimer Malbin siya. Take note lang unsay mga colors, because again gina-ask po Japon siya sa boards or sa other exams, po gina-ask Japon siya unsay mga unsay possible colors, no? Unsay mga necessary na ganun, no? So that's for the summary. So this is from Strassinger. Take note, WBCs purple, glitter cells is pale blue. Ayan, take note. WBCs purple, glitter cells pale blue. Alright? And yes, okay. And then, yeah, okay. Then you have the casts. Take note, it's pink. Hyaline cast, pink. Ayan, kakam pink. Yes. And this is the summary put for your, the different techniques, no? Especially from Brunzel. So take note, there's yan na yung gibutan, kinsa itong mga mo polarize and dili mo, o kinsa itong mo polarize and kinsa dili mo polarize. O, diba? So as you can see, diba, very important na gibutan na gini brand cell. So very easy lang to remember. Okay? So isa itong mga dili mo polarize, RBCs, casts, and mucus. Ay, pasensya. Dili dahil mo polarize ang casts and mucus. Ayan, pasensya. So this lang mo polarize, you have also bacteria and cells, no? And cellular debris. However, kinsa itong mga mapolarized, the crystals, no? Monohydrate kaox, fibers, ayan, amorphous crystals, and mga cholesterol droplets. So sila na mga mu diffract sa light into two, ayan, into two directions. Alright? Take note of that. So ayan, that's a summary na from Brunzel. Okay? Now for Brunzel ulit, unsa may mga factors daw that require standardization. Remember that for each laboratory na mo process, nag yung mga different changes or differences in how a laboratorian process is a specimen. So that's why para in a way ang results nato kay reproducible and standardized, we need to standardize the following parameters, which I have already mentioned, but of course the urine volume. So inyo lang i-sabutan, no, or i-stipulate kuna siya sa inyong protocols. Unsa dapat ang urine volume na kailangan, unsa ang speed, as I've mentioned, time, concentration of the sediment, 10 is to 1 ba, 12 is to 1. Volume of the sediment, how much magyud? Mugamit ba tayo automatic pipette or pasture pipette ra? And of course, reporting of the results. So, say format, is it more on quantitative? Range ba siya? 0 to 5, 5 to 10 per HPF? Or is it words like rare, few, moderate, many? Inana ba? So you have to discuss that and establish that. Again, for the purpose of standardization. Okay? Alright, so that's for, this is still from Brunzel. Okay? Ayan. So, dagan ako mga Brunzel na ginabutang diri dears. But at least, no, if ever sa review good, I'm pretty much sure, no, ni-mention na sa akong friend, si Ma'am Leia, of course, sa Lemar, the best, Brunzel na siya tikuha ang yung information sa iyang review sa CM. So, that's good, no? I'm not sure sa Pioneer Basin po, padulo na sila Brunzel because again, based on recent board exams, medyo sa Brunzel daw, tikuha o questions. And more on analysis na yun, no? So, shucks! So, paano na yan? Sige lang. We'll do our best, no? So, I think mga case studies silang pasabot ato. So, we'll do our best to ano that, to address that. Okay, all right, sige. So that's for the introductory part, in a way, of your microscopic exam. Okay, all right, sige. So that's for, again, the introductory part of your microscopic exam. All right, okay. So we now continue na talaga to the main, the main star ng Pasko ng ating discussion, which are the different sediment constituents. All right. Now again, for this part, atong humanon lang is the cells. Okay, kay medyo marami rin sila. For the second part of your lecture or second part sa microscopic, we'll have the casts, crystals, the artifacts, and reporting. medyo mataas-taas pero murag kaya ra nato na mahuman. Okay? Hopefully, sana din ako ma-overestimate. But anyway, again, so we'll start first with the cells. Okay? So of course, for the cells, starting first with the blood cells, which are your RBCs. Alright. Now for RBCs, according to Strassinger, of course, this is the most difficult, no, for a student to recognize. That's actually true, no? Okay, medyo lisod yung identifying RBCs because your RBCs can mimic a lot of other sediments, and most of them are actually, most of these sediments na yung gina copy or gina mimic or similar yung appearance, these sediments are non-pathologic. Okay? Muna yung ano lang, disadvantage. Kaya medyo lisod yun siya i-identify. Alright? But again, in a normal urine, fresh urine pa lang, of course, the RBCs is smooth, non-nucleated by concave disc. So in a way, same siya appearance yung muhang blood smear, wala na siya gistain. Okay? So again, na siya essential pallor gapon, no, by concave discs. Alright? And when viewed from the side, take note, iyahang shape daw kay hourglass. So, diba? So, this is from Brunzel and Graf na description, no? Ang iyahang side daw, when viewed, is hourglass ang shape. Alright? Now, of course, when your specimen is not going to be preserved, alright? Or if your urine could be concentrated or dilute, then of course, the RBCs will respond to these changes. Number one is, of course, when your urine is hypertonic, meaning it's too concentrated, of course, the RBCs will crenate, okay? It will crinkle. it will shrink. Because remember, hypertonic, concentrated ang gawas na concentration or taas ang concentration sa gawas compared sa sulod sa RBCs. So, unsay buhaton sa RBCs, magpagawas siya og fluid, okay? Para ma balance, no? Ang differences in concentration, di ba? That's why mahimo siyang more shrink siya, more crenate, okay? Crenated cells. In contrast, if hypotonic, meaning dilute kaayo, no? Dilute kaayo muhang urine, gamay ra ang solute sa gawas compared sa muhang concentration sulod sa RBCs. So to compensate the differences in their concentration, di ba? Water will go inside or will be absorbed by the RBCs. Hence, your RBCs will swell, alright? And what happens if muswell na mulays, marilis ng hemoglobin sa imuhang environment, okay? And this will produce what we call your ghost cells or the shadow cells. Nako, ayan. Akala mo sa ano lang, akala mo cells na yung nag-ghost? Akala mo tao lang ba ang nag-ghost? Ang cells po, alright? Feel ko may mga kilala kayong ganito, mga ghost cells? Charot, ayan, tsaka lang. The ghost cells or the shadow cells, ayan. So take note, hypotonic urine. Hypotonic urine, remember lang, muna siya na analogy, no? Kung hypotonic, gamay ang concentration sa imuhang urine, alright? So therefore, what happens, mas dagang concentration sa sulod sa RBC. So to compensate the differences, you have, the RBCs will absorb water para madilute ihang sulod, okay? Kay gamay lang kayong concentration sa gawas. So para ma-balance, okay? So pag sige niya absorb water, mulays siya. Okay, muswell siya, no? Mudako siya, alright? And then mulays. So that results to an empty cell membrane known as your ghost cell or shadow cell. And of course, RBCs na naghang mga protrusions, fragmented, no? Due to glomerular dysfunction or glomerular membrane damage, then that is known as your dysmorphic RBCs. And the most common of the dysmorphic RBCs is your crenated or echinocytes, no? Crenated cells or your echinocytes or Burr cells. Ayan, echinocytes or Burr cells. So how do you differentiate the Burr cells from acanthocytes, diba? For echinocytes, nako, hima na naman. Echinocytes, iyahang protrusions kay equal, no? Equal or even iyahang protrusions. Meaning, iyahang protrusions kay even. Meaning, ana-anag yun. Like, same rin silang appearance. Ayan. Pero for acanthocytes, muna siya'y Burr. For acanthocyte or your for acanthocyte or your spur cell, iyahang acanthocyte kay difference, you have different na mga shape, parang maabotong ilana, ganun. So, dili even iyahang protrusions. Okay? So, that's the difference. Iyahang appearance. Okay? Alright, sige. Ang pangit ng drawing. Okay. Burr cell, mga Hamilton fans dyan. Yes. Okay. Si Aaron Burr, sir. Charot. Tsaka lang. Okay, ayan. Sige. So, that's for your dysmorphic RBCs. Again, the most common is your echinocytes or the crenated cells. Your crenated cells is also known as your echinocytes. Okay. Alright, sige. Whew. Okay, sige. Alright, sige. Ako lang i-check na po. Alright, sige. So, again, part of the reason nga nung lisod yun i-identify ang RBCs for a beginner, it's because daghan siyang look-alikes. Ayan, daghan siyang mga look-alikes or daghan siyang mga kapareha og nawong. And what are these? Of course, you have the yeast cells, the oil droplets, and of course, air bubbles. Now, take note. For yeast cells, the yeast cells are ovoid. Ovoid ilahang. Your RBC is really round, diba? Or spherical. But for your yeast cell, it's quite ovoid. Ganito. Ayan. Ovoid. And sometimes, nasa'y budding. Nasa'y gamay na bud. Ayan. So, connected sila, diba? Remember, mga yeast cells. So, that's the difference. For oil droplets and air bubbles, ang oil droplets kay highly refractile. Okay? Meaning, pag shift mo sa fine adjustment na medyo murag mo, ano siya, mo sinag-sinag, mo shine siya gamay. Alright? So that's for oil droplets. And for air bubbles, of course, still the same gyapon, medyo refractile siya. Okay? And the best remedy, good dears, is to add 2% acetic acid because 2% acetic acid will lyse the RBCs and not these other sediments. But take note, if before ka mo lyse, before ka mo add acetic acid, make sure na na-count na nimong RBCs or examine na ka sa RBCs. Kaya if muad ka acetic acid, alright, mulays ng RBCs, mawala na sila. Okay? So, possible na din sila makita. Alright? So, pwede lang ka muad 2% acetic acid to make sure lang na mawala itong mga interference na RBCs. If you want to examine more, okay niya. Katong mga RBCs kay basin, ano siya, kanang annoying, or maglisod ka identify kung kinsa ba siyang RBC or yeasts. So you could add the 2% acetic acid. Okay. Normal values, of course, RBCs are normally found in small numbers, no? Small numbers good sa urine. Okay. Possible lang of mga, you know, normal processes like mga slowing, no? S-L-O-U-G-H. Slough, dagay na. I'm not sure how to pronounce. Sloughing, kanang pagtangtang yun, normal process lang. Or ginagmay ng mga injuries, ginagmay lang, no? Sa imuhang urinary tract. So, 0 to 2 to 0 to 3 cells per HPF ang normal. Pero once na gani mabot nag 10, okay, greater than 10 per HPF or mabot na siya 20 kapin, then that's indicative na good of a serious injury or serious disease sa imuhang urinary tract. So what are the possible clinical significances? Of course, renal disease, yes, lower urinary tract disease, extrarenal disease, toxic reactions, and physiologic causes. All right, so it's not only kidney ang origin sa imuhang blood. Pwede po siya, pwede other diseases, no? Such as, katong, I think, am I right? I think pancreatitis and appendicitis, if I'm not mistaken. All right, or what? Mali. Okay, wag na lang. All right, okay. Ayan, sige. So majority, good dears, the presence of RBCs in your urine, somewhat if daghan, they indicate your damage, no? To your tubular system or sa imuhang kidneys, no? Sa imuhang nephron, sa imuhang mga tubules, or sa imuhang other organs in the urinary system. Okay, all right, ayan. Whew. Okay, all right, sige. So that's for your RBCs. Very important, the presence of RBCs, again, could indicate, as I've mentioned, damage, no? And once na na yung mga casts, ayan, once na nagani na yung RBC casts, when we go to the discussion on casts, then that could indicate, very important, a glomerular damage. No, take note of that. Glomerular damage, because remember, the presence of RBC casts, the presence of RBC casts, or casts, for that matter, in your urine, it indicates the involvement na good of the nephron. Because asa man ma-form ang casts, sa yung mga tubules. Alright, so the presence of casts sa imuhang ihi, it indicates damage na to your nephron. Okay, so that's for your RBCs. Now take note, among the dysmorphic RBCs, diba? We mentioned that for dysmorphic RBCs, ang pinaka-common good is echinocytes. Pero the presence of acanthocytes, ayan, the presence of acanthocytes, dearsts, studies indicate that 5% or more of the RBCs in urine sediment are acanthocytes mangani. If 5% or more na RBCs sa imuhang urine sediment kay acanthocytes, it indicates glomerular disorder. Alright? Kung acanthocytes good, 5% or more ang makitaan. Okay? So, for the dysmorphic RBCs, but we mentioned that dysmorphic RBCs, it points to glomerular damage. Kung 5% or more ana kay acanthocytes, it really indicates glomerular damage according to studies. Okay? Alright, sige, that's for that's for the RBCs. Okay. Oh my God. Yes. Okay. Medyo I'm not feeling well, I think. But anyway, laban lang. All right. Sige. So, ayan. So, again, as I mentioned, RBCs can be mistaken as your yeasts, oil droplets, air bubbles, and even WBCs, dearest. Kung makrinate imuhang RBCs, pwede siyang mu-appear as WBCs. Aside from that, pwede po siyang mu-appear as your monohydrate calcium oxalate crystal. Because na-ay appearances ang monohydrate kaox na crystal na medyo ovoid, ayan, or spherical lang appearance. So, pwede siyang mamistaken as RBC. Okay? Ayan. Sige, that's for the possible identification errors of your RBC. Another is, of course, if mulays siya, in the case of hypotonic urine, of course, hemoglobin will be released. Okay? But if the amount of blood is not large enough, okay? Example, 3 plus below ra siya, alright? Then the protein pad will be negative, okay? Pero kung 3 plus and above, nagani imuhang blood, alright? So that's high amount of hemoglobin, pwede na siyang ma-detect sa imuhang protein pad. So mo positive po din mo protein, okay? Kung high amounts of hemoglobin na yun, or high amounts of lysis. Pero if 3 plus below lang, imuhang reading sa reagent strip, then that indicates if 3 plus below lang imuhang blood reading, the protein pad will not be positive. Okay? Alright. Ayan. Yes. So, kung 3 plus and above imuhang reading sa blood, then expected mo na ang protein pad ni mo positive because na-detect na niya ang hemoglobin. Okay? Alright. Sige. Whew. That's for the RBCs. Now, we're going to do the different images. Ayan. So, here again, the normal RBCs, diba? Perfect kaayon siya na pagka-RBCs, no? So, again, you have here a biconcave disc. You have the central pallor sa tunga, ayan. And then here sa right is mga microcytic, ginagmay na RBCs, and crenated na RBCs na lies, ayan. So kanisya, dears, muna siya mong lantawan. Mara siya donut shape, no? Sa urine, you have to look for that if maklaro, ayan, mga inana yung appearance. Naji murag dimple, or in a way, na murag kaning inani, murag central pallor sa tunga. Or mara siya donut yun, ayan. Donut appearance, RBC yun na siya. Okay? Alright. Another one is, of course, your dysmorphic RBCs. Ayan, as you can see, damaged na siya. Dili na siya itong perfect na sphere, yung shape. Yeast cells, as you can see, na siya budding. Ayan. When I say budding, katuni siyang ginagmay. Ayan. The daughter cell. Ayan, as you can see. And medyo oval yung shape. Alright. Next, you have, of course, oil droplets. Diba mara siyang RBC? Pero as you can see, it's highly refractile. Meaning, pag imo siyang i-ana ang fine adjustment, medyo mura siyang mu-shine. Okay? Shine, dream, smile. Charot. Muhayag-hayag siya gamay. And then, of course, air bubble. Ayan, medyo dako gyapon. Uniform ang appearance niya. Wala siya katumurag circle. Wala siya katumurag center, di ba? Katumurag, mura siyang dimple or sa center. Okay? Same po sa oil droplets. Ayan. And this is from Brenzel, dears. Ayan, gisummarize na niya. Okay? Imuhang mga other RBCs or other dysmorphic RBCs. Ayan. So, you have the Burr cell, the ghost cell, of course. Acanthocyte or also known as the G1 cell. Take note, if 5% or more sa imuhang dysmorphic RBCs kay acanthocyte, it indicates glomerular disorder. Target cells, schistocyte, of course, ayan. Same ragyapon, no? So these dysmorphic RBCs, of course, happen not because of changes in your urine pH or urine concentration, okay? It's not because of that, okay? It's because of the damage sa imuhang glomerulus. So pag-agi niya, alright, or pag-agi sa RBCs, na-damage po siya. Kay imuhang glomerulus mismo, kay damage na po iyahang surface, damage na po iyahang tissue. So pag-agi sa RBCs, of course, maka-incur or makakuha po siya damage. That's why it causes dysmorphic RBCs, okay? Alright. Aside from that, dears, take note that lysed, no? RBCs will lyse, no? In hypotonic urine and alkaline urine. So take note of that. There's alkaline urine and hypotonic urine. It will induce the lysis of your RBCs. Okay, take note of that. All right. So these are the different dysmorphic among RBCs and types of RBCs that can be found in your urine. Next, you have again the summary of the different microscopic features. This is still from Brenzel, dears. Ayan, ginapin lang ako siya kay very important. Kay baka lumabas na talaga sa boards. Ayan. Ayan. So of course, we have mentioned this correlation with physical and chemical. If negative ang blood strip, pero you can see RBCs, then it could be that look-alike rin mo nakita or na lyse ng mga or na ascorbic acid interference. Sorry. So again, pas negative siya sa blood strip or blood reagent pad, pero nakinakitang RBCs sa imuhang microscopic, it could be that, number one, possible na look alike rin mo nakita, diligod siya RBC. Another is ascorbic acid interference. Alam nyo na yan. Okay? Alright, sige. So that's for the RBCs. Okay. Next, of course, you have the white blood cells. Okay. Let me check sa dears. Baka may nalimtan ako. Okay, wala ra. Alright. Now, for WBCs, take note. For WBCs, ayan, usually the increased number good in WBCs indicates infection or inflammation. Alright? And infection may be bacterial in origin or non-bacterial, and of course, inflammation in your kidneys. Alright? Now, your WBCs, actually, the five of them, diba? The five of them, NLMBE, alright? Silang tanan, neutrophil, lymphocyte, monocytes, basophil, eosinophils, makit, and gusto sa urine. Alright? But among them, the most predominant is, of course, your neutrophils. Alright? Siya yun ang pinaka-common na WBC makitaan sa urine. Alright? And what is the appearance? Granular. Na siya granules with multi-lobed segmented na mga nuclei. Take note of that. So, that's how we determine, no? We look for the different, we look for nuclei sa imuhang cells sa WBCs. Okay? So, once exposed to hypotonic, same gapon siya sa RBCs, muswell imuhang WBCs. And in the presence or pag-examine mo sa microscope, iyahang granules kay mura siyang musidlak because of this swelling. And this is known as your glitter cells. Alright? And glitter cells, wala man siya significance good kaayo. It's just that iyahang appearance mura siya gasidlak, glitter, because of the swelling. No, the granules will move, or because of the Brownian movement of granules, it will appear as if it's glittering or it is shining, shimmering, splendid. Okay? And this is known as your glitter cells. Now, using Sternheimer-Malbin, what is the expected color or staining? For glitter cells, it's pale blue. For leukocytes, it's pale pink. Depende gyapon siya sa imuhang manufacturer's dears. Basin mag-ask mo na, sir, lahi lagi itong sa table sa stress. Depende siya sa manufacturer. Okay? So, kung sa mga colors. Pero again, remember lang, glitter cells is pale blue. Take note of that. Glitter cells ang pale blue. Alright. Now, identification error, of course, RTE na mga cells. Alright? And crenated RBCs, pwede po. So, how do you differentiate? toluidine blue, di ba, for the RTE, and acetic acid, pwede po for RBCs. Normal values, of course, 0 to 5 to 0 to 8, okay, cells per HPF, alright? So, take note, there's, again, same sa RBCs, there is normal gyapon na makita ng WBCs in your urine in small numbers. Yan na, 0 to 5 to 0 to 8. But again, same sa RBCs. For WBCs, if it's greater than 10, 25, or maabot na gitsag daghan jud kaayo, then that indicates infection. Alright? So again, significance, infection, inflammation in the genital urinary tract. Okay. Alright. And of course, unsay term nato for increased, no? Number of WBCs in your urine, it's pyuria or leukocyturia. Leukocyturia. Okay. Alright. Ayan. Sige. Okay. So very important, good, to remember, dears, that, very important to remember, Jude, that if increase in WBCs indicates infection, good. All right, it's suggestive of renal origin, especially if WBC clumps, no, kumpul-kumpul na gid siya. All right, so it's significant gapon to report WBC clumps because usually it indicates renal origin. Okay, because it's highly suggestive of possible infection dito gyud. Pero it's not really conclusive gyud na gikan siya sa renal origin. For the presence, for the daghan kayong WBCs na naa, na nag-clumping na sila, that could indicate a possible ano, significant infection. Alright, okay. Pyuria can also be seen in patients with appendicitis or pancreatitis. Pwede na maabot siya dito, no? Mga possible na effect po sa disease mismo. Alright? And aside from that, hypertonic urine, same siya o result sa mong RBCs, no? In hypertonic urine, the WBCs will also lice, will also swell. Alright? Sorry. It will shrink. It will shrink, and in hypotonic urine, it will swell. Alright? Hypotonic or alkaline urine. Alright? And the number of WBCs in alkaline and hypotonic urine decreases by 50%. Ayan. It will decrease by 50% within 1 hour. Ayan. After collection, if the specimen is kept at room temperature. So, pwede siyang ma-disintegrate, no? Pwede ka ma-false negative sa mong microscopic. Alright? Pero sa leukocyte esterase, ma-detect na siya kahit pwede man siyang ma-detect ang mga lice na WBCs. Okay? Pero again, the best good is to examine the specimen as soon as possible. Because again, in alkaline and hypotonic urine, WBCs will decrease by 50%, take note, within 1 hour if delivery mo siya at room temperature. Okay, alright, ayan, sige, that's for WBCs. For RBCs, the ideas, take note, red blood cells, take note. How do you differentiate sa imuhang menstrual contamination and okay, yeah. If ever magani increased lang imuhang because of menstrual contamination, no, imuhang RBCs nakita nimo, how do you differentiate? Of course, you look for other sediments. If naagani mga casts, okay, aside from RBCs, then that could indicate glomerular in origin or kidney origin gud siya. But for like casts, tas wala po yung proteinuria, it could be that katong increase in number of WBCs is due to menstrual contamination. Okay? Kung yahang protein kay negative lang or gamayra, alright? And wala po kay nakitang casts and other sediments that could point to a kidney origin, then possible na menstrual contamination na siya. Alright? Take note of that. Basin makadawat mo in the laboratory. Na yung inana, na nai, ang urine niya ka, ang urine kay contaminated with menstrual blood. Okay? Alright? Sige. So that's for your RBCs lang to siya, nalimot kong mention ganina. Okay, alright, sige. Now, we go now to your different pictures, of course. Ayan, WBCs, as you can see, what you look for, dears, is kini mga different circles, ayan, nuclei sa tunga. As you can see, daghan siya. Because it's multi-lobed, okay, yahang nuclei. And this is your glitter cells na unstained. Di kayo siya klaro na nai-glitters, ayan. Pero, nasyong murag sidlak-sidlak in appearance. Okay. Ayan. And take note again, WBCs nimo, alright, daghan siyang lobes. Because again, it's multi-lobed. Yahang nuclei segmented. Alright. Next, you have here phase contrast microscope, as you can see. These are neutrophil degeneration. So in cases lang na, of course, madugay, no process, mo-degenerate ang neutrophils. One of that is pag-degenerate nila, yahang nuclei kay mo-fuse para sa ani. Ayan. Mo-fuse ang nuclei and mo-forms like bleb. Ayan, mga cytoplasmic bleb na mga protrusions. Example, kanisya. Ayan. Another one is the formation of your myelin forms. Ayan, ito. Ganito. myelin forms ng mga filaments and disintegrating neutrophils. And pag disintegrate nila, there's possible good na maglisod na kaog, identify nila. Because again, dili na sila katong normal na appearance, so pwede na maglisod na kag-identify. Okay? Alright, so that's for degenerating na mga neutrophils. Because again, nadugay ni mo process, nadugay ni mo examine, so possible na ni degenerate siya. Alright? So again, pwede itong mga cytoplasmic blebs. Okay? Alright? And aside from that, pwede itong mga long filaments na mga myelin forms. Alright? Aside from that, pwede pong mag-vacuolization ang WBCs, alright, ng mga finger or worm-like projections ng mga cytoplasmic blebs, pwede. Alright? So dito siya, pwede siya inani ang appearance. Okay? Degenerating na neutrophils. Alright. Next, na WBC is of course eosinophils. Now, take note lang, dears, basta eosinophils, the first disease gyud that should come to mind or kung asa gyud siya significant is acute interstitial nephritis. Drug-induced acute interstitial nephritis. So, this is a type of disease, allergic disease, no, to a particular drug. So, di ba? Pag allergies, di ba? Remember, kinsang increase ng WBC is of course your eosinophils. Alright? Take note, nganong highly significant ang eosinophils? It's because once ma-detect niya or if ma-detect ang increase niya, then the doctor or the laboratorian can indicate na or can already think na, okay, this is due to drug-induced interstitial nephritis. And once ma-detect na to siya, of course, it's drug-induced, di ba? Remember. So in order to save the patient, a treatable Roshana disease, very treatable. How do you treat? Of course, you let the patient stop taking the drug para ma-prevent na ang reaction. Kaya if madugay pa siya, it could lead to damage na sa kidneys. Okay? If dili siya maagapan agad-agad. That's why it's very significant and it needs to be reported or it needs to be identified as soon as possible. Okay? So again, what is the stain of choice? Your Hansel stain. Okay? So Hansel and Gretel. Charot. For significant values, greater than 1% lang of the eosinophils and a 100 to 500 urinary WBC diff count. So 1%. Ano sa mga 1%? 10 to 5? Joke, dili. Tama, 1 to 5. Tama ba? 1 to 5? 1%? Hala, yes. Tama, 1 to 5. 1 to 5 lang na number of eosinophils in a diff count of 100. Let's say, nag-diff count kag 100. If greater than 1 imuhang nakita, then that's significant. If 500 imuhang diff count, greater than 5, ayan, imuhang nakita, then that's significant. Alright? Less than 1% ang normal value. Okay? Sa imuhang eosinophils. Alright? Again, clinical significance, huwag na mag-isip, dear, so sa eosinophils, sa urine, nako, ka mga case studies, nako, huwag na mag-isip, drug-induced interstitial nephritis. But aside from that, in cases of UTI then and renal transplant rejection, pwede po siya. Pero primary yun na disease, kung asa makita ni muhang eosinophils sa drug-induced interstitial nephritis. Okay, wala nang iba. Charot. Okay, ayan, sige. Next, we go now to the different types na lang, other cells, the mononuclears, no? So I think wala na ko niya na, ano, dalasin yung notes, pero ako rin dyan po nang i-post, so kalma lang. Alright? So for mononuclears, it includes the monocytes, lymphocytes, macrophages, and of course, the histiocytes. So these are usually present in small numbers lang in your urine. Okay? And starting first with the lymphocytes, of course, the lymphocytes are really small in number. So sometimes, sila makita. Alright? The most prevalent are the small lymphocytes. Usually, makita po siya sa pyelonephritis, pero because neutrophils man ang predominate sa pyelonephritis, dili na siya ma-detect. Alright? Pero asa siya pinaka-important sa renal transplant rejection. Because in patients with renal transplant rejection, ang lymphocytes ang predominate. Okay? So it's readily identifiable using your cytodiagnostic urinalysis using Papanicolaou's or right na stain. Alright. Next, of course, monocytes and macrophages. Remember, monocytes, macrophages, these are all phagocytic cells. So, same regapon, ilahang function is more on phagocytizing, no? Different bacteria, viruses, complexes, antigen antibody, no? RBCs, organic and inorganic substances sa urine. Okay? So, it's more on phagocytizing or mga housekeeper duties, ganun, okay? So, macrophages, of course, are derived from monocytes. And these macrophages, if nasa sa tissue, di ba, interstitial tissue, they are known as histiocytes. So still the same, And diseases such as mga renal tubulo interstitial diseases, such as katong acute interstitial nephritis or other na mga renal diseases, it may cause an increase in the number of these cells, monocytes and macrophages. Same with lymphocytes, say ang best method is to identify through the cytodiagnostic urine analysis. So you use a cytocentrifuge. So we'll discuss that when you go to CSF, no? Cytocentrifuge, ayan, and you stain it using Papanicolaou's or right stain. Pero ang difference lang or ang disadvantage, the monocytes may be mistaken as your RTEs. Kaya medyo same silag appearance. But take note, the RTEs may assume different shapes, no? Pwedeng dili siya cuboidal gyud, no? Na siya polygonal shape or whatever. So, muna siya one of the differences or how to differentiate. Okay. So, here's an example. Lymphocytes in your cytospin urine sediment and you have here the macrophage. Kanisha, of course, is the neutrophil. Macrophage is quite bigger, all right, compared to your neutrophil. All right. Okay. So, that's for the mononuclears. The lymphocytes, monocytes, macrophages, and your histiocytes. All right. Okay. Now remember, take note, dearsts, for LE, na chemical pad, diba? Or the leukocyte esterase reagent strip na parameter, of course, ang iyarang ma-detect are the granulocytic na mga cells, white blood cells. So, of course, the BEN, basophil, eosinophil, and neutrophil, and the monocytes. Lymphocytes, take note, will produce a negative leukocyte esterase reaction because they don't produce the esterase enzyme. All right, okay. Now, again, similar to RBC, Brunzel, ayan, summary gapon. Look-alike elements of your neutrophils, dead trichomonads. Yes, the trichomonas, pag dili na siya motil, all right, pwede siyang mo-exhibit as a WBC. Pwede siyang ma-mistaken as a WBC. So you have to be careful, all right, in identifying the trichomonas. Okay, dapat the best gud siya if motil, kay maklaro gud. But if dili, it could be a challenge. Okay, created RBCs, as I've mentioned, pwede siyang ma-mistaken as WBCs. And of course, your RTEs. RTEs, yes, especially the collecting duct na mga cells. Your collecting duct cells may be mistaken as the WBCs. Alright, okay. So yes, that's for the summary. So take note of that, dearsts. Alright. So those are for the blood cells, no? RBCs and WBCs. Of course, for RBCs, dearsts, wag na maisip. The clinical significance good is could be bleeding, no? Within the kidneys, within the nephron, especially if naay casts na appeal. So if naay casts appeal, you could really say na there could be bleeding within the nephron. For WBCs, of course, it indicates infection and or inflammation, all right? But take note, of course, there could be other causes, but primarily, mugunay disease correlation nato, all right? Okay, so that's for the blood cells. Next, we go on to the next type of cells, of course, the epithelial cells, all right? The epithelial cells, of course, normal parts, no, of your urinary tract, especially your urinary tract are, of course, tissues, all right? And tissues are made up of epithelial cells. Now, the majority of epithelial cells, atong i-discuss, are divided into three, of course. You have the squamous, you have the transitional, and of course, the renal tubular epithelial cells. So we'll start first with the squamous epithelial cell. The squamous epithelial cell is, of course, the most common of these of the epithelial cells and the largest among the epithelial cells. Pero among the other epithelial cells, kani siya ang pinaka least significant, okay? And aside from that, it's the only epithelial cell that is evaluated in the LPO. So siya lang yun ang gina-examine in the low power objective. The rest of your epithelial cells, asa siya gina-examine sa HPF or asa high power, all right? Now again, it's the most common. It is the largest, as I've mentioned, abundant irregular cytoplasm with prominent nucleus. Ayan, usually centrally located, pwede po siyang walay nucleus. All right? And take note, flagstone shaped. When you say flagstone shaped, irregular yung angle, no? Irregularly angled yung shape, flagstone shaped. All right? So this is still from your Brunzel. All right. Now, asa makita ni mga squamous, of course, lining the urethra and vagina. And for male urethra, usually sa distal portion or sa lower portion of the male urethral urethra. Okay? Dito dapit na padulong sa gawas na yun. All right? So, dito dapit. All right? Imuhang squamous epithelial cells. All right. Now, identification error, of course, folded cells, kaya pwede siyang ma-fold, it may resemble casts. But take note, imuhang epithelial cell, squamous, na siya yung nucleus. So you look for the nucleus. All right. It could be folded, kaya pwede siyang ma-fold because of, you know, changes in the environment or pwedeng ma-agitate siya, so pwede siyang ma-fold. All right. But take note again, na siya nucleus. All right. Now, clinical significance, of course, wala. Except na lang for this variation of your epithelial cells known as the clue cells. All right. Now, the clue cells, again, siyang significant na squamous epithelial cell. The clue cells is, of course, indicative of bacterial vaginosis. All right. So, these are epithelial cells covered with bacteria, specifically Gardnerella vaginalis. Naku, alam nyo na yarn. Okay. Gardnerella vaginalis, gram positive. Okay. Cocobacilli, indicative, again, of bacterial infection or vaginal infection rather, no, bacterial vaginosis. All right, your bacterial vaginosis, actually it's not only caused by G. vaginalis, primarily good Gardnerella, but it's actually a synergistic infection between Gardnerella and an anaerobe, okay, which is your mobilungkos. So take note of that, dears, no. If I question mobilung, I think mobilungkos ni na wrong spelling ko, I think mobilingkos, pasensya, no? So yeah, muna siya ay anaerobe. So basta na question dito, dears, now which of the following is a cause of bacterial vaginosis? Tapos walay Gardnerella, then you have to answer mobilingkos because mo po siya ay next na common cause. It's an anaerobe. Okay, all right. Now of course, how, when do you consider a clue cell? Dapat ang bacteria niya, ang bacteria nag-cover good sa epithelial cell about 75%, and dapat mo extend ang bacteria pag cover niya beyond the cytoplasm. So if muna siya ang epithelial cell, so dapat ang bacteria niya kay anag yun nag-cover 85% and mo extend pag yun beyond, no, mo extend pag yun beyond, so it's really covered by bacteria. All right, so that's a clue cell. Okay, again, indicative of unsa na disease, bacterial vaginosis. Okay, and kinsa usually ang organism causing that, you have Gardnerella vaginalis. Naku, wag na mag-isa. Press the buzzer na. Oy, agad. Alright. Now, take note, dears. Ang nucleus ay squamous epithelial cell is similar in size to your WBC or even an RBC. Okay? So, pwede siyang different sizes iyang RBC. Okay. Alright. Sige. Whew. Alright. Sige. Okay. All right. Take note, there's your squamous epithelial cells, as na mentioned na, it can be folded, all right? And it can even be rolled, no? Pwede siyang ma-roll, all right? Into a cylinder, all right? Basta pwede siyang ma-roll or ma-fold. Okay? So, because of that, pwede siyang ma-mistaken as a cast, kaya na-fold man siya. All right. Okay, sige. That's for your squamous epithelial cells. All right. So, here's an example, of course, the sex SECCS, ha? Squamous epithelial cell, and you have here the clue cell. Ayan. As you can see, ang clue cell is of course kanisha. Ayan. So as you can see, shaggy, no? Bearded, mura siyag na yung mga protrusions. So mura siyag shaggy. Mura siyag fur appearance. So mura siyag na yung hair, ganun. So shaggy or bearded appearance. The normal epithelial cell, ayan. And shaggy, bearded. So kanisya tanan, dears, muna siya bacteria. That's the Gardnerella vaginalis ni muna mga bacilli. Alright? Now, because of its large-sized, dears, imuhang epithelial cell, this can also, your epithelial cell or squamous epithelial cell is usually used as the point of reference, especially if magsugod palang kaog examine sa microscope, no? It can be used as your point of reference. Okay, so magsugod palang ka-examine, example sa LPO, so para makabalo ka na you're in the right field, no? In the right track, baby, I was born this way, ganun. If you're in the right field, then you look for a squamous epithelial cell or squamous epithelial cell because it's big and it can be readily seen. Okay, so if makakita na kag squamous epithelial cell, then of course, you are already assured that you are in the correct viewing field. All right, because again, normal good na naay squamous epithelial cell. No, a squamous epithelial cell is of course again released in your urine because of normal sloughing, slowing. Limit ko sa pag-pronounce. Slough, slow. S-L-O-U-G-H. Please comment below. Charot. Pronunciation. Charot. Sloughing or slowing of your old epithelium. Of course, imuhang urethra and sa imuhang urinary tract. So of course, pwede makita yun ang squamous epithelial cell in your urine. Pero again, if midstream clean catch siya, if midstream clean catch yun ang ihi, of course, medyo konti na lang epithelial cell. Because again, the first part of the urine na eliminate itong mga epithelial cells na naa sa imuhang sa first part or sa lower portion sa imong urethra, na eliminate na siya sa first part sa imong ihi kay midstream man imong gi-catch. Okay, pero if daghan kayong squamous epithelial cells imuhang specimen, it could indicate contamination, no? Wala siya nag midstream clean catch, wala na properly collect iyang specimen. Okay, all right, so that's for the squamous epithelial cells. Next, of course, is the transitional or urothelial transitional cells. So these cells are, of course, lining the renal pelvis, calyces, ureters, and the bladder, especially the bladder, all right? And upper portion of the urethra sa imuhang males. No, sa males, sa upper portion sa urethra, kay medyo napadto ang imuhang transitional. Because again, mo pa yung mo control, no, sa ihi, mga sphincter muscles ditong dapita, yes. So, para mo, diba transitional, it can change in shape, it can change in size, no? So, na siya sa upper portion, sa urethra, sa males. Alright. Now, it can be seen in singly, in pairs, or in clumps. Alright. Now, appearance, it can be different, no? Again, it can assume a lot of shapes, no? It can be spherical, it can be polyhedral, and it can be caudate, meaning na siya tail-like projection. In the in the uppermost or superficial layer na mga cells, or in the uppermost or superficial layer sa imong tissue ditong dapita sa pelvis, no, sa calyces, ang pinaka-common na shape sa imuhang transitional epithelial cells are round, no? Round or pwede siyang pear-shaped, alright? In the uppermost or superficial layer, pear-shaped or round, iyahang shape. Now, pag-abot niya sa intermediate layers or trigone region of the bladder, dito na ang elongated or caudate. So, mga trigone or inner layers na sa bladder, alright, dito na ang elongated or caudate. So, ang round or pear-shaped kay superficial layers lang of the bladder and renal pelvis and all that. Pero kung inner, middle layer na, tama, middle layer, intermediate layer of the trigone region, ayan, of the bladder, then that's already elongated or dito na ang caudate. Alright? Elongated or caudate. Dito na siyang dapita. Alright? Inner layer, alright, of the bladder. Okay, alright. Okay. Whew, sige. Alright. So of course, ihang nucleus, take note, dears, it's centrally located. So same siya sa squamous, alright, centrally located. Nagi siya sa tunga, alright? Identification error, it can resemble RTE cells, ang spherical forms. But take note, the transitional epithelial cells are quite larger compared to your RTE. Okay. Now clinical significance, increased numbers without any invasive procedure such as catheterization is indicative of abnormal morphology, abnormal diseases, alright? So, in cases na increase imuhang transitional epithelial cells, alright, na napadyo abnormal morphology such as na vacuoles or irregular nuclei, then that indicates, again, malignancy. Pero if the patient underwent invasive procedures such as catheterization, then that is the result, no? Or it can lead to increase in transitional cells, imuhang catheterization, alright? Okay, ayan. So, here's some examples. So you have the polyhedral, spherical, and caudate. Ayan. So as you can see, ang polyhedral kani siya dearest, and caudate medyo na siya sa inner layers na of your bladder. Ang spherical, ayan, round or pear-shaped, siya ang nasa outer or superficial layers. Okay. All right. Now here is your syncytia, again group of your transitional epithelial cells. Again, it's from a catheterized specimen, di ba? Syncytia or groups of TEC, transitional epithelial cells, can be seen after catheterization. Here's a comparison. Your sec, as you can see, polyhedral ang squamous. And as you can see, the transitional central nucleus, pero the shape could be spherical. Dili in ani na polyhedral or irregularly, irregular angle, all right? Or flagstone, ayan. Now, here's an example of your round TEC and a caudate. As you can see, na siya murag tail-like projection gapon or tail-like appendage. Okay, ayan, sige. Whew. All right, sige. That's for the TEC. Okay, next we have your decoy cells. Your decoy cells actually, it's a transitional or RTE that is affected by the BK virus. Now, BK virus, diba, it's under the family Polyoma viridae. Ayan, so if na remember pang virology, I think wala na. If na remember pang virology, Polyoma viridae, BK virus, no, it can affect the kidneys and it causes hemorrhagic cystitis. Ayan, if na remember pa, hemorrhagic cystitis, ang BK virus. Alright. Now, iyahang characteristic cell, ayan, as you can see, is known as, it has an appearance of comet-like cells. Okay? Pernay differences, it changes the cells, no? Nuclear enlargement, as you can see, dako kayo ang nucleus. Ayan. Chromatin clumping, may mga clumping along the nuclear membrane. Abnormal chromatin patterns ni Shadir's, and the presence of cytoplasmic vesicles. As you can see, ganun siyang comet-like. As you can see, ang nucleus niya kay marasyag ni enlarge and marasyag ni it moves away from, ayan, it's moving away from the nucleus. So, mura siyang comet. Okay, so comet-like cells. Take note of that. So, that's for decoy cells. Aside from that, it can also be associated with renal transplant rejection. Okay, if the patient doesn't have any BK virus infection, possible na renal transplant rejection siya. Alright? Okay, that's for the decoy cells. Okay, take note of that. So, usually this can be seen in cytocentrifugation, dear. Cytodiagnostic, no? It's for cytology na mga purposes. Makita nyo na siya dito sa cytology. So, usually gina-perform sa histopath na section, no, to detect malignancy and other mga viral infections that could have changed, no, mga cytopathic effects, oh, di ba, sa viruses. Okay. Alright, sige. Whew. Laban ng taani, no? okay, sige. So, that's for the decoy cells, alright? So, decoy cells, primarily BK virus, good, no? Decoy siya, ano siya pasabot na decoy because possible na decoy, di ba? When you say decoy, it's not really true or para siyang ano rang stand-in or parang it's not really true, parang ganun. Because similar siya with the cells, it can be mistaken as other cells of malignancy, no? It can be mistaken as other malignant cells. That's why it's called decoy cells. Okay, alright, ayan, sige. Okay, that's for the decoy cells, alright. And of course, you have next the RTE, no? The renal tubular epithelial cells. The renal tubular epithelial cells are considered to be the most significant among the epithelial cells. Why? Because again, renal tubular, nasa pangalan na, asa manigikan sa mga renal tubules. So, therefore, the presence of these cells in your urine indicates damage or diseases in your renal tubules, affecting na yun the nephron, okay? Because the origin of this is, of course, the nephron, okay? So, the presence of this in your urine indicates damage na yun or possible na disease imuhang nephron, okay? Now, the appearance, as you can see, it varies in size and shape depending on the area of the renal tubules kung asa siya gikan. It can be rectangular, columnar, round, or cuboidal, and take out siyang nucleus, eccentric. So, when you say eccentric, it is off-center. Okay? It's off-center. Alright? Wala siya natunga. Okay? Ayan. Na nucleus. Take note of that. Ang transitional squamous epithelial cells, the nucleus is centrally located. Sa tunga yun. But for RTE, it's eccentric. Wala siya natunga. Alright? Off-center. Okay? Again, remember that the renal tubules are involved in reabsorption, secretion, di ba? So, possible po na the RTEs can be laden with pigments such as bilirubin or hemoglobin. Alright, so it's not unusual to have mga bilirubin laden or hemosiderin laden na mga RTEs. Greater than 2 RTE, as you can see, as little as 2 lang dears, no? Yeah, greater than 2 RTE per HPF yung makita indicates tubular injury na good. As little as 2 lang. Because again, it indicates na good na, ah, okay, shocks, na nag-yoy mo rag damage sa renal tubules. Kaya nagpagawas na siya RTEs ay muhang ihip. Alright? Now, we have different types of RTEs depending on their tubules. You have the PCT, proximal convoluted tubule cells. These are usually oblong or cigar-shaped. So, pataas. Alright? And in appearance, it may resemble granular casts. So, pwede siyang mamistaken as granular casts. Eccentric nucleus gapon, dense chromatin pattern, and it can be multinucleated. The DCT, the distal convoluted tubule, is round to oval. Eccentric gapon, dense nucleus with granular cytoplasm. And for collecting that CD na cells, siya ang cuboidal, polygonal, and columnar. It's rarely found spherical or round. Okay? It's rarely round or spherical. Cuboidal siya. So, mara siya cube. Okay? Polyhedral or polygonal or columnar. Alright. Single, large, moderately dense nucleus that takes up 2/3. So, mas dahoy ang nucleus. And the cells of the CD, collecting duct, in groups of 3 or more is known as renal fragments. Okay? Alright. Clinical significance, of course, as we have mentioned, increased amounts in your urine indicates tubular damage or tubular necrosis. Alright? Problem na yun sa mong tubules. Could be na-damage na or padulong na sa death of your tubules. Okay? So, it's really significant. Okay? Alright. Sige. That's for the different types of your RTEs. Okay. Whew. And take note, there's again, it's slightly larger, alright? Slightly larger than your WBCs because we have mentioned, diba, that WBCs and RTEs can be mistaken, diba, for each other. But again, the RTEs are larger. Presence of more than 15, as I've mentioned, presence of more than 15 per HPF is suggestive of renal disease. Newborn infants have higher na number of
RTEs compared to adults? Because again, medyo bata pa sila, so basi nag-form pa ilang tubules, no? So possible pa na ma-introduce ang mga cells dito sa ihip. Alright? Okay, ayan, sige. Alright, okay, sige. That's for the RTEs. Okay, but again, remember ha, less, greater than 2 lang. Greater than 2 RTE. For Brunzel, it's more than 15, no? More than 15. In the presence of more than 15 na RTEs per 10 HPF is indicative of tubular injury. Okay, all right. So here are some pictures. Ayan, as you can see, ang PCT dears is again cigar shaped. So as you can see, brush and cast actually. But as you can see, nasa yung nucleus sa tanga. You have the DCT, which is round. Okay, round ang shape. Ayan. Next, you have here the renal collecting duct. Epithelial cells, as you can see, dako ang nucleus, diba? It's 2/3, no? Ang yahan na occupy, alright? And it really resembles AWBC. That's why we mentioned that the renal collecting duct epithelial cells can be mistaken as your WBCs. Okay, alright, ayan. So here, ano ra gyapon? Renal tubular epithelial cells collecting duct gyapon. Alright, okay. Next, you have here a, ano, tani? fragment of renal epithelial cells, as you can see, dagko siya. Columnar, ayan, columnar na epithelial cells, alright? We mentioned that pwede siyang renal, pwede siya sa collecting duct, yes. Your collecting duct cells could be columnar, ayan, parehas ani. So, fragment yun siya, dako yun siya, di ba? So, daghani siya ng mga, usag yun siya, murag, usaka part yun sa tubule or murag surface, no? Daghan siya, no, fragment. And then you have also the spindle forms, which indicates regeneration after injury, ayan. So, nagka-injury na, pero pag-regenerate, nag-regenerate, naghinahina yung imuhang tissue sa tubular epithelium. So, na-introduce po siya, no? Spindle forms. The presence of spindle forms in ani indicates again that your tubular epithelium is starting to regenerate, no? Nag-try siya heal after the injury. Okay, alright. So, here's an example again. Columnar, as you can see, di ba? Or cigar-shaped mura siya, granular cast. Okay? And then you have here oval RT. As you can see, the nucleus is eccentric. It's not center. Off-center siya. Alright? And cuboidal, and you have RTE cell with hemosiderin. Ayan. So Prussian blue, na siya color blue na mga granules. Diba? Remember the Rouse or Roos na test. Okay? Alright. Because again, your tubules are involved in reabsorption. So possible na ma-introduce ang hemoglobin sa imuhang tubules, iha nang i-reabsorb. And the hemoglobin will stay or it will become ferritin into your semen tubules, and once madenature ang ferritin, may mo siyang hemosiderin, and muna siya itong madetect sa imuhang Prussian blue staining. Alright. that's for the different types of RTEs. Okay, so take note of that. Most significant yun siya, because again, the presence of these cells in your urine indicates tubular injury. Alright, okay. Now we go now to, of course, the variations in your RTE. Alright, variations in RTE, of course, you have the oval fat bodies. By the name itself, oval fat bodies, these are RTE cells, even actually macrophages and other pwedeng WBCs po that contain fats. Okay? And this usually indicates renal tubular cell death or glomerular dysfunction. So take note of that. It can indicate renal tubular cell death or glomerular dysfunction. All right, and it can be identified through, of course, the lipid stains, your Sudan 3 oil red O, orange-red, again, for neutral fats such as your triglycerides, and polarizing microscopy for cholesterol, because cholesterol cannot be stained by your lipid stains. Clinical significance, of course, nephrotic syndrome. So it is seen in mga kidney diseases na na-damage ng glomerulus or the nephron that leads to the excretion again of mga large molecules such as your fats. And these fats will be absorbed by the RTEs, alright, and even macrophages. That's why nasalimrag mga fat globules, alright, sa ilahang cell or sa ilahang sulod. And that's known as the oval fat bodies. Another one is bubble cell. Instead of fats ang sulod sa RTE, it is mga bubbles, alright, or mga vacuoles, alright. And this indicate tubular necrosis pa rin. Alright, so bubble cells and oval fat bodies. Alright, so here's an example. Ayan, oval fat body. As you can see, nasa yung mga fat globules surrounding the cell. Ayan. Ayan, so mga fat globules. Ayan, and you can see the cells sa ilalong, pero natabunan siya yung mga fat globules or fat droplets. That's an oval fat body. Next, you have here stained by lipid stain. Ayan, lipid stains. Sudan 3 man yata ni. Or oil red O. Sudan 3, ayan. And you have here the bubble cells, kanina yung mga arrow. Ayan, this is the bubble cells, which indicates again tubular necrosis. Ayan, large vacuoles, ayan, sulod sa imuhang RTE. Okay, and that indicates tubular necrosis. Again, these are your bubble cells. So, marasag naidako na bubble sa sulod. And that's a large vacuole. All right, okay. Okay, ayan. And of course, RTE, oval fat body na ang sulod kay cholesterol. Under polarizing microscopy, again, as you can see, Maltese cross, no? Maltese cross. Now, for reporting of epithelial cells, kinsa na mga rare, few, moderate, many, of course, your squamous and transitional epithelial cells. For squamous is LPF, and transitional is HPF. And for average number per HPF is, of course, your oval fat bodies and RTE cells. So, don't worry about reporting, dears, kung saan siya pag-report, no? Nai-reporting man di, ah, yes, charo. Kung saan siya pag-report ang mga sediments natin ni Monix, ana, towards the end, padulong sa last part. I will share. Alright, so again, here is a summary gapon. This is from Brunzel. Ayan, so, paki-ano na lang. Lantawara, dears, just read about it. Ako ni i-post gapon. Alright. And then here's an example of the tubular cells, no? Collecting duct, as you can see, pwede siyang dako kayo nucleus, alright? Pwede siyang columnar. Ang DCT is really round, no? Or spherical. And ang proximal is cigar-shaped. Okay, alright, sige. That's for the different squamous epithelial cells, alright? And here's an example of a picture, ayan, letter A. Of the katong mga parehag na wong, yes. Letter A, as you can see, is the transitional. As you can see, dako dyan ang transitional. Letter B is the... RTE, as you can see, F eccentric, na eccentric, wala na natunga iyahang nucleus. And the letter C is your WBCs. As you can see, gagmay ra yung WBCs compared to your RTE. Okay, and transitional yun ang dako sa tulo. Alright, so, ayan, i-differentiate ng tulo ka in case, di ba, makita ninyo. Alright, so take note of that. Basta ang RTE, dears, take note yun, eccentric, no? Na off-center iyahang nucleus. Alright, and for transitional, it's still central iyahang nucleus. Okay. And mo assume gyud siya og usually spherical, polygonal or caudate. Ay mo squamous epithelial cell mangud kay medyo sharp edges siya ba? Sharp edges na polygonal. So murag mga ay sorry. Whew, okay. I am tired. Charot lang. Ayan. So sharp edges, parang ganun. Ayan. Imuhang squamous epithelial cell. Whereas for your transitional, it could be anara. Alright, or polygonal, ganun. Pero dili siya sharp edges. And again, your squamous epithelial cells, pwede siyang mo-fold. Alright? Ayan, sige. So that's for your epithelial cells. Alright. Now, again, we have here this bladder diversion, no? Abi na road lang ay diversion, charot. So this is still from Brenzel. When you say bladder diversion, na yung mga diseases, no? Congenital defects or diseases in which kailangan tang tawo ng bladder, alright? Urinary bladder. So what happens is wala na kay bladder. So unsa na lang imong ihi, alright? Asa man padulong imong ihi. So what happens is there's called bladder diversion. So what happens is mukuha og tissue, usually from the colon or small intestine, and mo-create sila og bladder, alright? Or mo-create sila opening sa imuhang tiyan para dito mo gawas ang ihi. Alright? Now, because of that, you use tissues na from the small intestine or colon, your urine, therefore, will now contain no cells coming from those organs, small intestine and or large intestine, such as mucus, increased numbers of WBCs, bacteria, and even epithelium, which could include goblet cells, and as well as increased amounts of degenerated cells and debris. So therefore, mas challenging imuhang pag-examine sa urine of patients with bladder diversion. Because again, ang nahitabo na, na-incorporate na itong mga normal cells sa imuhang intestine dito sa ihi. So medyo magliso na kag-decipher kung kinsa gyud ang gikan sa kidneys or kinsa itong gikan po sa intestine. Okay, so it could be a challenge. Alright, so these are some methods of bladder diversion. As you can see, ang ureter, i-connect ni mo siya o ileum, so sa small intestine na part, ayan, and then mugama ka o stoma or opening diri sa abdomen para dito mugawas ang ihi. Another one is one part of the ureter ang mugawas, alright? Mugamag opening, alright? Or mugama kag pouch, ayan, kani. Pouch diri sa tunga, and this pouch comes from tissue sa imuhang small intestine. Okay? Para again, siya mo hold sa imong urine because you don't have anymore a bladder. Alright? Kaya na problema yung imuhang bladder. Alright. Okay, so that's for bladder diversion. Again, that's seen in cases na gubay mong bladder, congenital defect, kailangan i-remove. Alright, okay. So those are all for the epithelial cells. Alright. Now for the last part of this lecture, we're going to go now with the microorganisms. Of course, ato na yung scan through dears, kay easy lang yun ni mga microorganisms. Of course, starting first with bacteria. Your bacteria, of course, they may appear small, spherical, of course, cocci, and of course, bacilli, mga rods. Now, for UTI, the clinical significance of your bacteria is, of course, UTI. Generally, normally, dapat urine in the bladder, of course, does not contain bacteria because your bladder is sterile, okay? Pero pagawa sa bladder, of course, muagi na imong urine sa urethra, all right, which contains normal flora and other external organs, all right, so which could introduce, no, mga normal flora. That's why there are normal amounts of bacteria sa imong ihi. Pero the increased number good bacteriuria, it means na UTI, all right? And what is the most common cause? Na ako na mention na nato is of course the enterobacteriaceae, especially E. coli, all right? But aside from that, of course, you have the cocci, staphylococcus, enterococcus, and even mga yeasts po, all right, that can cause UTI. Identification error, of course, it may resemble amorphous phosphates and urates, and of course, as I've mentioned, UTI, yahang clinical significance, especially if daghan pong WBCs na naa, because that indicates the presence of an infection, UTI. All right. Next, of course, yeast cells. Ayan, as you can see, budding, oval, and nasa mga pseudo hyphae. All right. Again, it may or may not bud. Okay, pwedeng wala siya bud cells. Inanira siya, pero nasa pseudo hyphae. All right. And through yeast infection, there's of course, if na WBCs. So that is caused, of course, most commonly caused by Candida albicans. No. Again, seen in vaginal moniliasis or candidiasis, and of course, as I've mentioned, diabetes mellitus, de ba? Because again, the DM, increased glucose in your urine, will provide, no, a conducive environment for your Candida albicans to grow, and it will upset also the pH balance in your urinary tract, which leads to the proliferation of your yeasts, especially sa mga females, all right? And we also have another yeast, your Candida glabrata, that can be seen as ingested by WBCs, all right? Phagocytized within WBCs. So identification error, again, can be mistaken as your RBCs. How do you differentiate? Pwedeng magamit kag acetic acid. Ayan. And clinical significance, yeast infection, dapat na IWBCs. Alright? So if you can see WBCs and then I yeast, then the patient may be experiencing from candidiasis. Okay. Next, of course, for parasites. Nako, ano no? Gasgas na gasgas. Pilaguta ka months ng parasitology. Yes. Of course, for urine, the most frequently examined parasite or recovered parasite is, of course, Trichomonas vaginalis. Take note, it was described by Branzol as turnip shaped. Turnip, kika na mura siya vegetable, di ba ang turnip? Ayan. Turnip-shaped flagellate. Ayan. Pear-shaped flagellate sa Strassinger and other references. Again, agent of trichomoniasis, ping-pong disease, usually reported as rare, few, moderate per HPF. Or some laboratories will say positive for or Trichomonas vaginalis seen. Now, again, as I've mentioned, it would be best or its identification would be easier if it's motile. So, if fresh ang specimen, makita nyo na motile pa siya. But if prolonged ng specimen, prolonged standing ng specimen, unpreserved, no, of course, it will lose its motility and mamatay po siya. And once it is dead, the trichomonads, no, it can be mistaken as WBCs because of its appearance, all right? So it's best good to identify it sa fresh specimen kay motile pa siya. All right. Next, you have, of course, S. hematobium, schizosoma, prominent terminal spine, of course, blood fluke, best specimen is 24-hour unpreserved urine. And diba, remember, unsa tong time frame, best to collect pud if dili 24-hour, diba, urine, you collect urine at a time between 12 p.m. to 3 p.m. 12 p.m. to 3 p.m. or 12 p.m. to 2 p.m. depende sa based sa different references na itong gimension. I remember pa ba? I think wala na. Okay. Sige lang. 12 p.m. to 2 p.m. or 12 p.m. to 3 p.m. Alright. And you have Enterobius vermicularis ova. Again, the most common fecal contaminant. D-shaped egg, di ba? Italian baguette ova. Tadpole-shaped embryo. Ako, palang wala na nina remember. But the most common fecal contaminant is, of course, E. vermicularis. Remember, di ba? Especially for females, dugol ra ang anus and the urethral opening. So remember that the E. vermicularis adult lays the eggs on the sides of the anus. So possible siya ma-introduce sa ihi, pagpangihi. Pwede po ma-recover ang adult worms actually sa imuhang urine. Pero that's dili kay common. Ang common yun is the ova. And of course, Georgia pud, according to Branzel, fecal contaminant yapon, all right? So especially if the patient is exhibiting parasitic infection, bisag kunsa na parasite, tapos na fecally contaminate siya, all right? So especially if mga intestinal parasites, of course, then this parasite or these parasites can be seen in your urine if na fecally contaminate iyang sample. And then napagod siya parasitic infection, all right? Okay, all right. So these are the possible parasites na makitaan sa urine. And the last for this discussion, dears, Yes, tama. Are the mucus threads, all right? Mucus threads palang last. So your mucus threads are of course threads, no? Mas lag mga ribbon, ayan, ribbon-like structures with low refractive index, so possible siya mo blend sa background, ayan, and may have striations, so na siya mga lines, alright? Identification error, mara siya hyaline casts, and same sila og constituent or major protein found is, of course, the TAM horsefowl protein or the uromodulin, alright? Now, generally, wala siya clinical significance, dearest, alright? It can be present normally in your urine because, again, your RTEs, the renal tubular epithelial cells, produce uromodulin. Pero in abundant, nagani, increased numbers of your mucus threads indicates inflammation or irritation of the urinary tract. Possible na naka-infection, no? Or possible na nag-strenuous exercise ka, possible na irritation sa urinary tract. Okay? So, abundant lang. Katong daghan na yun kayo. Pero, it's normally found, no? In normal amounts or small amounts lang in your urine. Because again, it's a normal constituent, no? So, generally, wala siya clinical significance. Pero if abundant na gani, daghan na kaayo, then that indicates inflammation or irritation of the urinary tract. And heavy mucus threads, katujung daghan, it can incorporate your WBCs. Pwede mo tapot ang WBCs dito. Alright? Okay, so that's for the mucus threads. Alright? And that's for the end of this lecture. Oh, pasensya, dears. Medyo sabaw na ako kay medyo gabi na ako nag-record and medyo not really totally feeling well, pero sige lang. So I hope nag-gets to first part na to, or first two parts na siguro. Ilang taon ako kung sa length, ani. Anyway, I hope nag-gets lang to, alright? And for the next part of our lecture, we're going to continue now with the casts, crystals, artifacts, and then finally the reporting, alright? For the microscopic exam. Alright, so I hope nag-gets lang. If you have any questions, dears, again, do not be shy to ask questions. Alright, just PM me for any of your questions and I'll try to answer them as soon as possible. Alright, so thank you, dears, for watching. I hope makalanta pa mo ani. Alright, thank you, dears, for watching. No, keep safe and God bless. I'll see you in our class, next pre-recorded lecture or sa live session. So thank you, dears.